Welcome to this conference and webinar arranged by the MaCE project.
My name is Deborah Taras, and I'll be co-presenting today with
Trine Skjevstask. That is tricky to pronounce in English, so we decided let's swap it between us.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah. So we'd like to do a very warm welcome to our peers here today in Norway, but also to our peers who are online as well. So hi, lovely for you to join us, hopefully in the UK and Denmark and across the globe.
Let's think big, hopefully across the globe.
And could we just say for our colleagues who are on... Could we just say for our colleagues who are online that you are able to ask questions while we're live streaming, and Katarina has sent you an email, so please feel free to ask questions as our guest presenters are on the stage.
And to open this conference, we have our Vice Principal, Jarle Tommy Bjerkholt, and our coordinator for this project, Mette Bunting, that will start today and give us a little introduction on MaCE.
Thank you very much. First of all, I also like to welcome you all to the University of Southeastern Norway, and I'll take this opportunity also to present a bit of the university to you. And of course, thank you also for inviting me to open this conference. We don't know how many people there's out there that is watching this, and it might be thousands and thousands. University of Southeastern Norway is a very young university, but an old institution. We gained our university status just a bit over a year ago and 4 days. before that, we were a university college joined by a lot of other small university colleges. And we are situated here in Telemark, Vestfold and Buskerud region, which are counties here in southeast. It's at the moment 3 counties, but it's not only the universities that are joined together. Also, the counties and the municipalities are doing the same. So they're getting less in the very near future. From next new year, there will be only 2 counties in this region. And at the moment, we're about 700,000 people living in this area. As I said, 3 counties and 52 municipalities. It's a quite large area, but therefore a mix of small and a little bigger cities, and of course there's a lot of countrysides and mountains available, wilderness. For those of you who like to explore a bit more around in the area of the university. The actual nature or landscape is diverse, so is the businesses in this area. And the university has a very good cooperation with both businesses, small and medium-sized businesses, and world-class large businesses with the globe as market. And we also have a very good cooperation with the municipality and municipalities and other public or rest of the public sector. And there's a lot of other type of industry going on in this area as well. As I said, we are a university joined together with from all other small universities. At the end, for 3 years ago, we were 2 university colleges joined together in this new institution, University of Southeastern Norway. Here is our campuses. There is a campus in Bø, which is about an hour drive from here, inland. And there is a campus in Drammen, which is closer to Oslo. campus at Kongsberg, we can see there's a map there. Is it working? Yeah. Harrisburg, Drammen, Kongsberg, and Hønefoss, Notodden, where we are now, Porsgrunn, and Vestfold, and Rauland, which is up in the mountains. None of these, well, there is a, I had to modify this statement, but none of these campuses are very big. There's no dominating campus. There is about between 1,500 and a bit more than 2,000 students on each campus, except Rauland, where it's only 150, and Hønefoss, where it's also a little less. All these campuses are have education and research that are strongly connected to the business in their area. I'm not going into detail about that, but there is a reason why they are situated where they are. We have, or our vision is to be regionally based and internationally competitive. Use or cooperate with the community around where we are. We are about 18,000 students, 1,500 employee, which about half is faculty staff. 8 campuses, as said. These numbers are changing all the time, so it's just a it's how it is, or was at the time when that slide was written. 65 bachelor programs, 36 master programs, and 8 PhD programs. I said they are changing, of course, programs shall develop, but there is also another reason why they are changing, because we are several institutions joined together in one. We have to organize ourselves in the best way, because there are some programs that are equal to others, that's why. Research areas: economy, management and politics, health and welfare, humanities, well, kindergarten, schools and higher education, maritime enterprises, nature, health and environment, outdoor life, sport and physical education, technology, traditional art, practical aesthetic subjects, and vision science. That's some of our main areas of research. The 8 PhD programs are within applied micro nanosystems, culture studies, ecology, marketing management, nautical operations, person-centered healthcare, process energy and automation engineering, research training, and in pedagogical resources and learning processes. These are the 8 programs. As other universities, we are sort of our core business is research and education and disseminating results and knowledge. In addition to that, we are doing this in integration with the businesses and society around us. That might not be very different from other universities, but we are doing it the way we can do it here in this region. We are aiming to develop and deliver world-class research and new knowledge within defined areas. We are, well, as I've said, regionally based with 8 campuses and close ties to regional-based industry operating in this area. Again, we look upon ourselves as a modern, innovative and entrepreneurial university. Then, this I think looking at the program of this conference, it's a very Right, it's an exciting program, and I'm sorry that I can't be here all day. I have to go to another meeting just after this, so I would very much like to listen to the talks that are given here today. It looks very exciting. And I'm sure that every one of you, whether you're in this room or out there in the space, it's not right. Might be some satellite transfer of signals, but you're obviously in another part of the world, and I'm sure that you'll get a very interesting day today, listening to all the different subjects that are taught during the day. And in addition to that, of course, I also have to say that I think this project, the MaCE project, is a very good project. You are very inclusive. You invite a lot of students into the project. You do research together with them, and I think that is it's very interesting and exciting to see how that is been done through the project. And as I understand, there's only 1 year left of the project period, and you have to apply for another one. You also have some good results from this project, so it should be a good basis for developing to a new program, I think. We need good projects and good programs. Just a little more general things. Of course, this half of you or less than half of you joining this conference is in this room, but it was said that it is possible to actually participate in the discussion by sending email to an email address that is distributed out there. And that, even not being in the room, is possible to participate, not exactly the same way as being here, but we have the possibility of some kind of interaction with the surroundings. And that's some of the important things by joining a conference. It's an opportunity to network, to meet like-minded other people working within the same area or with the same subject, but not exactly the same thing. It might be it's always some other kind of angle when you meet other people. You get to expand your knowledge and find solutions to problems. You can discuss your own research with others. They might have a completely different view. That's something you weren't thinking of when you started. But in that discussion, you learn new things. You present your ideas, you get to discuss them, you get to criticize them, or other criticizing you. This is a positive critic, and it's a very important thing of being a scientist. This discussion, critic, receive critic, discuss, and do that together with other people. And there may be people that are looking exactly for you. You present yourself. You have some kind of knowledge special problem that someone want to discuss with you, and they are looking exactly for you because they have been thinking of the same thing and need somebody to work together with. They look for partners. In many ways, maybe, but at least science partner in science, and there'll be new ideas brought to the table, and there'll be many other reasons for joining a conference, and you are in that situation that you may be able to take advantage of that situation. And you get the possibility of learning beyond your field. And I think that is to be able to broaden your ideas and your knowledge, you have to push yourself outside your comfort zone. And a conference like this or any other conference actually also is an opportunity to learn something new, extend your knowledge, push your borders. And with that, I think that I will, I don't know whether I shall declare it for open, but I wish you a very good day here in Porsgrunn, or for that those of you that are out there somewhere, together with us here in Porsgrunn. And I hope you have a wonderful time here at the Porsgrunn campus and the university, and also a wonderful day in science. So thank you all. And welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, then my name is Mette Bunting, and I'm so lucky to coordinate this project. I feel very honored because it's a great gang of both students and faculty that is part of the MaCE project. Just a moment, I'm just going to get my my presentation up. So this is the picture of a fantastic gang. And you might not know who's the teacher or the faculty member and who's the student, and that's a point, and you will hear more about it. What I'm going to do now is just to say a little bit about the project so that you have a framework to understand what's coming afterwards. Because my colleagues and then again myself, another one, are going to present some of the preliminary results. As Jarle said, we are now 2 years into the project, one more year, and we had 1 year with students participating. So there are three universities included in this project. Of course, this one, as has been thoroughly represented here. And then it's the VIA University College from Denmark and University of Cumbria from Britain. And all these three universities are situated in areas where we have quite low educational level in the districts. And most of the students going to the universities are from the local districts around. It's also interdisciplinary. We have both representatives from the teacher education and also the social sciences as well. So the three partners, initially 9 lecturers, and then 31 plus students. This year we had 31 students. We were frightened we probably wouldn't get more than 8 or 10. So we were so happy when we got that many. And for next year, it seems like we get about the same amount of students. And also we have both master students and bachelor students together. So what is the idea of MaCE? What's the point of doing all this? Is it just to be a happy time together, or do we have some like a vision? And of course we have a vision, that an ambitious one, that we wanted to investigate and try to do the best we can. We wanted the students to be co-researchers, not only going to the bachelor or the master thesis and going out on their own and trying to find out what on earth is research after we have had the theoretical talk about it. We wanted them to be work alongside our the researchers in the field. We wanted them to be part of a community, research community, where we could have dialogues, discuss, and be available in a different way than we had perhaps been before in the studies. And in this way, we think that the students will be strengthened in the learning process and in the outcome of their theses, the master and the bachelor theses. And our also goal and hope was that eventually they will try to, the bachelor students might think, okay, perhaps I'll do a master as well. This is fun. This is something I can manage. And perhaps even some of the master students would like to take a PhD. Who knows? And we were very clear that the students' lived experiences is an asset to us that have started this research program. In many ways, the lived experience from school, from the studies, the age, the knowledge of the local community, that is helpful in making this research project even better, and that we can understand the data we find in a better way. Because we do research together on early school leavers, or some, like somebody called it, dropouts. And then through this co-creation and the methodology, which we will go more in detail into just afterwards, we wanted to develop a model with our experiences, how this not only could be a project for 2 or 3 years, but be something we can use into the education and also to work together with the local community to have to help young people who need more support to reach their goals. So that is the idea of MaCE. And this is a picture from when we went to Britain in the Lake District, and could be a picture of education and knowledge. And there's a lot of activities, which you will learn more about it, that we had to do to get there. Just informal being together, experiencing things, the in-between times is extremely important. Having playful exercises that we're learning how to know each other and also how to cooperate, how to co-create. Having dialogues, interesting discussions, students in between, students with lecturers, researchers, doing interviews, practicing, recording, transcribing, and also visiting each other's schools to understand the difference between the nationalities, the different challenges the nations have. Because all the three university colleges are in areas where nationalists consider challenging, but when you compare, there's quite a difference between the countries. So, to achieve our goals, we had to do certain things. And this is just an outline because you will learn more in depth about it. We have made an online course. We prepare it to do theoretically and methodology before we were going to meet. And then we also made an interviewing seminar, what we called face-to-face. Finally, we can see each other in person. And we have a national follow-up as well. And all these experiences and examples and courses, as much as possible, we have put out on the website that is for everybody to help themselves and use if they want to. Then, of course, it's out in the field to do research. And then afterwards, how to write, how to use the data, how to understand, analyze. And we had the writing seminar. The first face-to-face was in Norway. The writing seminar was in Britain. And, of course, national follow-up before we had peer reviews, etc., before that published in a journal. And being the Erasmus Plus project, we do have promises to keep. And we have been quite ambitious, and we're trying to reach a goal the best we can. And at the moment, we have sort of reached some of the goals. Some of the goals are on the way, and some we are working hard with in the last year. And the blue text, the three first points, that's something we are started developing and are not quite there, but getting there. The black ones is what we have finished making, but we will sort of refine it. And the last one is more like we have to work hard in the last year. So we're making two models, both for the education and higher education and school system. And we also have a goal about developing the master and the bachelor's education. And we have made a methodological course that we want to be available for others, that is presently on the website, the outline of it. And sort of a practical handbook for working with students, tips, you know, experiences we had, how we have met together, anything from ethics to corporations, to playful games, to learn to know each other and cooperate, etc. And then also we made a journal for students to publish their articles, which will probably deliver between 4 to 5 issues over these 2 years. The first one's coming in September, I think it was. But of course, impact. So today is doing the impact to spread it. But we want to spread it inside our institutions, of course, nationally, but also internationally. So all these we will go into more as we go along today, but this was just to give a little frame to have to understand or be prepared for the things that is following now. Okay, so before I just close this part, please visit our website. All the things that we have worked at and trying to give on to others, it's on our website. And we also have like a blog, Facebook page. We would love you to follow. And if you want to get in touch with us afterwards, it's a different contact numbers here. Otherwise, our contacts mail is also on the website. So if you just get the website, you will get all the rest of the information if it's too much for you to remember. Thank you. Then it's over to you, Tina.
Right. Thank you, Mette, and thank you, Jarle, for opening this conference for us. So, Sisse Hølvik Mikkelsen and David Tore Gravesen both work at the VIA University College in Denmark. And they will be the next presenters on stage. Sisse has her background in educational sociology and is interested in youth culture, interdisciplinary collaboration. I'm sorry, I need to read it from the paper, but it's also hard, difficult English words. And she's interested in teacher professionalism, inclusion practices, and vulnerable children and youth. And then over to David. His background is in educational sociology. He is interested in youth education, youth culture, leisure time pedagogy, pedagogues in primary and secondary school, and quality research methods. So welcome on stage.
Okay, thank you, and welcome to this presentation where we will tell you a little about our work in the MaCE project and show you some practical examples of our work. My name is Sisse Hølvig Mikkelsen, and together with David, I will start this presentation. So have we got our presentation somewhere here? Can you help with that maybe, David? Excellent. Okay, before we will show you some concrete and practical examples of how we have conducted the different phases in our project, I will shortly say a few words on the theoretical background and stepping stones of the project. Here, yes. One of the main ideas in the project is to involve the students as co-researchers and try to have as non-hierarchic academic structures as possible. So this is based on an understanding of knowledge as socially constructed. This means that in our project, knowledge is something we construct together through mutual interactions and in collaboration. So this way, knowledge is not something we possess obtain, but something we develop together, both scholars and students. Therefore, involving the students in all levels of the project and also trying to enhance motivation in this way has been crucial for us in the project. In addition, bringing them and us together across national borders and cultures in these communities of practice have proved to be very fruitful for all participants and for the project as a whole. So, now we would like to show you some examples of how we have conducted the co-creation in the different phases and parts of the project. Firstly, I will shortly introduce what we have actually done together. With the students, of course. Initially in the project period, we had an online course. Then we all met in Norway for this face-to-face meeting, as we call it. And then we had a writing seminar in the UK. The online course contained four sessions. Session one with an overall introduction of the project. Session two on co-creation and social cultural learning. Session three, with a focus on the education systems in Denmark, Norway, and the UK, and of course the differences between them. We We also had an introduction to the notions of equity and equality, and a focus on educational sociology, namely the concept of social reproduction, cultural capital, and habitus. The last session introduced the students to the indirect approach, which you will hear much more about right after this presentation. And all in all, the online course was an overall introduction to the whole project and the main concepts within it. Also preparing the students for the face-to-face meeting. So the overall goal for the face-to-face seminar was for the students to learn more about ESL, dropout, need, equality, literacy, and the indirect approach. The students were given a range of theoretical inputs and given time and space to apply this knowledge and new skills in practice. Then lastly, we had the writing seminar in the UK, which provided the students with short inputs on how to code, analyze, develop a line of argument, and structure an article. Many of these inputs and activities were introduced with very creative methods. So now we will go a little more into some examples of how we actually tried to facilitate this co-creation and learning. In the online course, it is the intent to provide the students with knowledge and competences, but also to start the co-creation. So this we tried to facilitate in different ways and with different methods. Here you can see one of the ways we tried to get the students to engage with the content of the session and to interact with us and the other students. It's a Padlet. It's an online blackboard where everyone can post different answers to questions and start discussions of the topics on the topics of the sessions. The students can also comment on each other's posts, and it's a way to get the students and the scholars to interact with each other and with the academic content. Yes. In session three, we also experimented with mapping and sharing our educational experiences and all the ups and downs and turnarounds many of us have experienced on our educational trajectories. This may not be a traditional academic exercise, but it's very useful in discussing young people's different ways and on their educational journeys. So, and it's a way of getting aware of which obstacles and difficulties you can meet on this journey of education. In addition, an exercise like this can be a very good stepping stone for more theoretical discussions too, using our own stories as the starting point. Yeah. We used both online lectures, but also pre-recorded lectures that the students, for example, could watch together with their readings as a preparation. But here we experienced it. That the recorded lectures were good as preparation, but didn't function very well within the sessions. Here the live streaming of lectures, where the students could interact with the lecturer and the content worked much better. So that was a good experience for us, so we can use that later on when we do the project again. Yes, and now to you, David.
Good day, everyone. Is it working now? Yes. Great. So, hi, my name is David. And how to follow up on a perfect presentation like that? Ooh. So, welcome, everyone. I will proceed here with the second step of the activities, the face-to-face meetings. In those meetings, I want to tell you about what we were doing, what was it all about. And the first one we had was in Porsgrunn in late October 2018. And we wanted to train the indirect approach and get to know each other. And five Danish students, 11-ish British students, and I think 18 Norwegian students, or around that number, and staff from three countries met up in Porsgrunn. We did a lot of silly games and tried to have some playful learning. And here you can see some of the examples of things we were actually doing. The big picture here is a game called The Snake, which is quite simple, because all you have to know to do this game is the rock, paper, scissors game. Should we try it? One, two, three. Mm-hmm. One, two, three.
Yeah.
Obviously, we can't do it. So, one, two, three.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, one, two, three. Okay, I win. And then you go on my back, and then we go like this. And in the room, everybody does that. And then you have all these small snakes, and ultimately, in the end, you have only one long snake. And the leader of that snake is the winner of the game. So this is fairly silly, and you don't really need many skills, except for knowing the structure of this game. But the game, silly as it might look, actually ends up with all the participants in one long snake. So a picture of the community and the togetherness of that we actually felt through such games is what you see in the big picture. We also did some playing with the Legos, which you can see in two of the other pictures. In small teams, we tried to compete to make the highest tower, which should be easy with the Legos. But the difficulty was that you had to collaborate very specifically with only using one finger per person, which meant that you have to pick up the bricks together and then put it on the tower, which is actually quite difficult. You should also you should all try it. So that was a collaboration in practice, doing it in a very playful way. We also had a drawing game, which is the upper picture to the right, back to back in pairs. One sees a picture and tells, and the other has to draw it from the other person's explanation. Why such games? Because it's untraditional in a formal and educational and academic setting, but nevertheless it helped us to create this informal, relaxed environment with a lot of fun, with a lot of time to laugh, and collaborating not only by talking, which is a very a regular and traditional manner in academic dialogue. Of course, we also had some theoretical inputs, not only funny games, but also regular lectures. And you can see some of the stuff that we talked about. We followed up on content from the online course, of course. Co-creation, aspects of social cultural learning, the equalities literacy model that we're trying to develop in this project. We also tried to cope with that in a practical way, reflecting on our own educational trajectories in new ways than the one that Sisse showed you in the light of the model and the theory. We did that through sketches and drawings too. We had lectures on the indirect approach, tools in interviewing, reflections on our role as researchers and research ethics too. So all the boring stuff we also had to get through, of course, which we did. And then ultimately we also tested and tried out the indirect approach on each other and with each other, student to student, but also student to student. Yes, and here you can see some pictures of the groups trying out these techniques, creating a room and a space for the narratives that this whole interviewing technique is about, trying to make room for the informant to start telling their stories instead of answering questions posed directly by the interviewer. So that was testing out this actually very difficult task. We ended with a great night and a bonfire in Porsgrunn, which was the culmination of a which was a culmination of a great week together after a lot of intense and joyful work. And finally then we had the writing seminar, which was pulled off in Brathay, England, late February this year. We had, degree records, so the weather was not icy, but we were eating. People were eating ice cream, and it was all over the news that these temperatures were groundbreaking, which was quite weird because it was just the end of February. It was quite lovely, of course, but it was also with thinking about the environment and all, but it was really nice, and you can see some lovely pictures here, of course, of the environment that we shared while we started our writing processes. So staff and students got together to start writing, forming writing groups, discuss writing style and genres, start coding data processes, and choosing topics for their articles. We have in this project two formats of articles that the scholars and the students can choose. One shorter article format, which we call the professional articles, which will contain an abstract, an introduction, the body of material, a conclusion, and references. And then we have a slightly longer version or format, which resembles a scientific article, which is contents an abstract, introduction, methodology, literature review, the body, and conclusion, and references. So, so at this writing seminar, we were trying to figure, after having collected data, like being out in the field and interviewing young people, like Mette told you, we tried to discuss individually in groups. Where am I? What are my interests? What are the themes? What are the emergent findings in my data? And then we had lots of writing time and feedback sessions, both in the national groups, but also in the bigger groups. And then, of course, there was some info about the deadlines that we all have to follow and are dictated by. And I will show you that. In a while. Perhaps now. No, just one quick example of an activity that we had at the writing seminar, which is also this Padlet exercise that Cissa also gave you an example of. So here we wanted to try out and see some emergent findings from our data and try to figure out what to even write about. So we set out for this Padlet exercise, where you can see that students can formulate a theme for their articles, and others could join that group and comment on each other's idea. So you can see on top, you can see some themes formulated and defined by students, and other students writing their comments and ideas below. And this is just one example of some of the interactive work that we tried to do, sharing and keeping thoughts and ideas also for later use. Because as you can see, this is just a screenshot of that Padlet, but you can and we can go into our system and see this Padlet still. And actually, if we wanted to, we could keep commenting each other's work here. And just to narrow it down and give you a few examples that are perhaps easier to actually follow, you can see here two examples. The first one to the left is three Danish students formulating a theme they want to write about the methodology in this project, the indirect approach. And they write, through the coding of our interviews, we have become more aware of the work with the method and to what extent we have used the method. This puts demands on the human competences by both the interviewer and by the informant. We experienced that the human relations response was quickly interrupted when we saw that we asked the informant a question, but they closed our questions before we had asked. Thus, we saw that the informant had some preconceptions for what we would ask about, and so forth. So here they are reflecting on a theme that they wish to write about, and other students can comment and perhaps join this initial group about of students writing about the methodology. The other one is another example from one of the Norwegian students who formulates or defines a topic of relation that she calls relationships with teachers. And she writes, students expressed concern that teachers disliked them through the way they spoke to the student and their body language. Another student from the UK comments this and writes, I found the same and had several comments about teachers having clear favorites in class and teachers having higher tolerances for negative behavior from students they liked. And this may seem very elementary, but it's very also very deep and very crucial for this whole project. So I think it clearly depicts the beauty of working together, the importance of these quite simple questions, and the difficulties we actually have in solving these relatively simple questions. And we had discussions about it even yesterday, and it's that is the core of the project, to try and solve some of these big issues. And as you can see, the students and ourselves are having these mutual discussions. Okay, so what's and just a few pictures here from the writing process. The left picture here, the coffee, the computer, and the view. The beautiful view, because when we met in Breffe, we were all enlightened by this beautiful weather and this beautiful sight. But we also did other stuff at the writing seminar than write. We had more playful, creative designing games. We had some great walks, and we had some great food and great nights together. And ultimately, like Mette said, it should all manifest itself in a bunch of articles published in our own journal, which is called the Journal of Youth Voices in Education, Methods, Theory and Practice. And this is to the right. You can see the coming web page actually of that journal. It's already up, but with no content except for the purposes. And I will read those to you. The purposes of the Journal of Youth Voices in Education. In education are to publish articles from students, researchers, and practitioners related to marginalization of young people and co-created education, to inspire others to pursue programs and research projects that tackle issues of marginalization and pursue co-created education, to enhance the quality of schooling, further and higher education across Europe, and encourage inclusion for students who have experienced marginalization and social disadvantage. So you can see these are great and huge purposes, but they're not. It's not only for this closed group, it's actually for everyone to publish. But in the first round of things, of course, we have to fill up this journal ourselves, but it's actually also open for future issues and for guest contributions from others doing all this kind of work that resembles what we're doing in this project, or from other students and scholars who pursue the same goals. And finally, to the left below, you can see that some of the students already handed in their articles. From some of the students from this first cycle already handed in articles, and the review process between students and national teachers are actually already rolling. And you can see just a quick example of that here with commentary track and all this. So we hope to see you all in the journal and share great experiences and discussions in that in those issues. And the first, like Mette said, should be actually ready this autumn in September. We have some strict, very very strict deadlines. Remember. So the first two issues of the first volume should be up and running this fall, and then next autumn we will have another volume with two issues, perhaps three. So this should be a great place for mutual reflection. So that's all for now, and we will pass the torch. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cece and David, and brought back a lot of really nice memories and a journey of how we've all been learning within the MaCE project. So thank you very much for that. Yeah. Next, I'd like to introduce Katarina Bodvik. Got that right? Yeah. And Gayu Musus. All right, as well, yeah. Are both working as researchers in the MaCE project and with similar research questions in a longitudinal project called Youths, Realised Education and Dropout in Telemark here at the University of Southeastern Norway. Gayu is an anthropologist and one of the great minds who has been working on developing the indirect approach. And Katarina is a university lecturer in special education and has great engagement for children and young people's mental health and well-being. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Geir, and together with Katrine, we will present the indirect approach. We will do this in two parts. I will talk about the basics, about some of the thoughts behind the approach, and then you, Katrine, will follow up with examples from how we used the indirect approach during the first year.
Examples from the, is it summer? From the interviews, from the informants and the students. External? Is it some?
Hello? Yeah. Okay, examples from the informants and the students after they've done the interviews.
Okay. So, okay, I'll start this part with some of the thoughts behind the approach. Of course, why do we call it the indirect approach? This is the first part. Well, naturally, this has to do with the power balance. And I think for this project we have, or for the indirect approach in general, I have two in relation to youth studies. I have two things I'd like to bring to the table. And this is all about a skewed or a very imbalance in the power between us. The first is this. It raises the question how to study young people who find themselves within a marginalized setting when the power balance is so out of order. Or there's always the risk of researchers bringing with them their own power into the research situation. The second is that how do we deal with the weight of society that ties us all together in ways we can't completely escape? It's not just that we can think away the power imbalance between us. It is there, even though we want it not to be. And this poses great challenges on us when we try to do this kind of research. These are principal questions we all have to address when the balance of power is like it is. But in this particular setting, this has to do also with the kind of society we are within today. We are living in what we could call the school society. We have developed into a situation in which school is almost everywhere in within our existence. It somehow become an imagined community that we sort of find difficult to think outside of. It is becoming a language that we are living within. And this poses challenges when you want to study young people inside education. How do you study dropouts, for instance, or early school leavers, as some would call it, when our shared language defines the normal as graduation? I'm an anthropologist. My thinking about this has been inspired by my ethnographic fieldwork. I've done my I've done a large study of youth in living in a heroin world with the consumption of heroin, and I encountered that as a secret place, as a place with its own rules. So you could ask, what do young people doing heroin have to do with students dropping out of school? Of course, very little. We do agree on that. But both are defined and labeled in particular ways within the cultural context of surrounding society. We cannot escape completely the labeling that society gives us. That's what I discovered being in this place I call Olagata, a shooting gallery of heroin. They developed their own ways trying to escape some of the effects of that labeling they were forced to deal with in their everyday life in the larger society. And that somehow could also be the case with young people living in a marginalized setting as early school leavers. And that inspired the indirect approach, so that I'm asking you to think of the school experience similar to the Olagata as secret knowledge. That it is not something that you have easy access to. It is often somehow tacit, secret knowledge that is not shared with everyone, simply because society at large is labeling you from the outside. Now, this poses challenges when your format of research is interviewing. What you do when you are facing this situation doing interviews? You are already there with your own language, a language saturated with power, which is already telling young people what the normal is, and that is graduation. And you bring this with you, and you cannot avoid it, being a researcher in a privileged position, coming as a student or as a professor from an educational institution. So our general idea is this. We want answers to questions we simply don't ask. And that seems like an impossible start out for an interviewing research project, doesn't it? But that's the general idea of this. We want to conduct interviews without asking questions. The idea is to turn the interview format with questions and answers into a storytelling situation. And this I'm much inspired by people like the oral historian Alessandro Portelli, who has been studying labor history first in Italy and later in the United States of America. And he has shown the importance of how these stories are connected in ways that don't necessarily correspond to the facts of reality. In this particular story, he discovered how the death of a local worker who was killed by the police was situated in a different setting from the one in which it occurred. Now, instead of looking upon this as noise or lies or manipulations, he saw it as as vital information, telling us something about the context that people make with their stories. This is why stories are so important. Stories are told to an audience, and when we become an audience, we are invited into that person's context, into that person's frame. And that is the ambition of the indirect approach, to break out from the interviewing situation into a storytelling situation. That's the whole idea of this project. It is to start out in an interview and turning it into a storytelling situation. How do we do that? This is where we introduce the concept, the happenstance, as trying to focus on this, what happens when how do we move from an interviewing situation into a storytelling one? And we believe an happenstance should be seen, looked upon as an unforeseen event, something that happens, something that turns things around. And of course that is difficult to achieve, but it's something we aspire or try to achieve during the interview session. Finding something that allows us to get into a situation similar to the one Portelli was having when he learned about how this worker was, the death of this worker by the police was set in another setting. Of course, we have to do start out interviews asking questions, but the ambition with these questions is not searching for information for its own value. It's more like trying to establish a conversation and finding communicative bridges into situations that give the informant both the space and the time to tell his or her story so that she would be making it a story he or she would give to a familiar audience. That's the ambition of the project, to get into that kind of situation where we become the audience of someone telling their story, thus giving us their context. Saying this as an introduction, now we're turning to the examples. Yes. How we achieve this.
Thank you. And now we will try to show you some quotes from four group interviews that we have done. That's done by the researchers in MaCE. Oh, sorry, I switch. Sorry. There, I put this down. First is some examples from 17 informants who have just been interviewed by the students. And second here, we will try to show some examples from the students doing the indirect approach. So you will see both sides in the interview situation, both the roles. Some of the interviews, some of the informants have actually been interviewed before, the year before, by the researchers in the project. Then we asked the students, the informants, about the difference between the interview then and the interview now with the students. And they said, girl 8. Because, as I said, the difference in age was much smaller. So it was much to relate to. And you understand more about each other. And you could go through more topics that are relevant then for people of our age. And a bit like, what's like living in this community here then, in the local area? Most of them mentioned that it was easier to talk to younger people than the researcher the year before. Even though some of the students were just as old as the researchers. The informants talked about the conversations, boy 5. It is a conversation with a friend. I felt like I had a free flow. I felt that we could talk about absolutely everything. Most of the informant talked about how it was a comfortable conversation, a good flow, a space for openness, where they felt no pressure, and where they felt recognized. Girl 4 says, also, they looked somehow, yes, they somehow was impressed when I said something that they were impressed with, and they somehow showed it. And it is so cool that you've done this and that, but then it was kind of weird, but also a little bit comfortable then, that someone is somehow interested in just you. So it is not always that you meet someone that just tell me somehow, and then you bring up your whole rap shit somehow. Also, you can decide what you want to talk about. So the interviews open up to conversations about what I want to talk about and my life. They also talk about having reflections about their own lives. Boy 3. It also made me think a little bit more about how my parents, in a way, my mother, has played a great role in which direction I've gone, and so with my education. Yes, I haven't thought of that directly before. In a sense, it tells and somehow makes it all clearer. Then it is easier to see, in a way, the connection between what I see. Girl 8. And like a speaker who once said, the most important conversation you have is between you and yourself. So that you actually get it all out, to bring out your own thoughts and your own events in life the last couple of years. It is so important to get to know yourself. Many of them said that the interview gave them an opportunity to reflect on their own life, talking about thoughts, dreams, and ambitions. And they even haven't reflected on them before. And having a conversation with themselves afterwards in their own mind. And now we will switch. The quotes before was from the informants. This is from the students who have done the interview with the informants from upper secondary school. The students also talk about the conversations and about their role as an interviewer, Sonia. Yes, you almost become friends, or that you can almost feel that you're bonding a little. Yes, a very relaxing style. Lena, it is perhaps a little easier to ask slightly more difficult questions if that person you're interviewing in a way also ask you deeper questions. Then it's easier to get into, yes, you feel like you can do it as well. They're talking about the feeling of closeness in the conversation and the importance of giving and take in a conversation. Both are sharing information about themselves. One of the students talked about the conversation as a dance, Sonia. But I felt that I was in a dilemma then, or that it was such a dance between me and one informant, because I really wanted to go in depth. But then I realized she always tries to get away from that question. Also, yes, that experience was a little bit special. You're talking about the dance? Yes, that too. And both of us were so aware of it, and none of us is talking about it. Lena, I was having two thoughts in my head during the whole interview. It was to catch what he said, but also all the time, how should I ask the question so it wouldn't be wrong? So it was all the time I had to listen, and at the same time try to make a good question. And you got tired of it, and very conscious of oneself then, really. Here they're actually talking about the conversation also could be like a dance. And the dance between how deeply we can go in an interview. And the dance actually between being in the process in the interview or have a focus on your own action research team. The students also mentions some limitations. Some of them are shown here. Ingrid. Also, you only walk a narrow path. You can't include everything. So it might have been okay to perhaps have taken a follow-up interview. Sonia. So it seems like it was a little difficult to implement the method 100%. And we had informants who might not speak Norwegian very well, who was very uncertain in the situation, then becomes more uncertain when there are such a wide frame in the method. So I noticed the difference then, when I was left with a feeling that this is a good interview. Then it was if the informant had the ability to tell stories and feeling confident about telling it and having a vocabulary to do it. This is just some of the limitations they talked about. The lost opportunities and the high demands on the language capacity and quickly becoming comfortable in new situations. But they talked about opportunity in using the method as well. Tone. I also think that the strength of the method is that if we have used our questions, categories, or things that we wondered about in advance, we might miss the unexpected. that we just hadn't spent time on it because we had our theme, our agenda. Peter. But it was kind of goal with that method to turn the situation a bit. The interview situation then, to make the power relationship change. And that when you might have managed it, if you get them to suddenly sit there and ask me things and interview me in a way, as you were talking about the power switch. Here they mention that the method gives opportunity to get more in, to get more of the narratives, but also about the power changes that you were talking about. The relationship between closeness and distance in an interview method.
Okay, just a final note on our experiences so far with the approach. Of course, this approach, it's born within an ethnographic setting where you have ample amounts of time developing the relationship with your interlocutors, your conversants. Whereas in this situation, we are forced to forced upon doing the whole research within a strict time limit. So we could talk about there being an ethical dilemma here, as well as what I would call an indirect enigma. It all comes to this. Some talk more than they wanted to when they are offered to into this kind of interview setting. That is some of the
examples
show us. Whereas we also have the opposite problem of others who won't talk, and they might have liked to do so. That's also an ethical problem in situations like this. And this is things we have to approach in the two fashions. First, this the ethical dilemma, how to allow young people to tell their story while not forcing them to do so. Mm-hmm. And we have to reflect upon on this in the second year of the project, how we improve the method so that we are able to get this balance. I think that's very, very important. And the second, of course, is the indirect enigma, for lack of other word, how to give young people an opportunity to share their story, not talking. You know, how do we use this, not forcing upon them a sense of inferiority because they lack the kind of elaborative talk that we are so good at as researchers. And we're talking about developing a toolkit with different ways of doing this, making using drawings, walk and talk,
pictures,
plays. Can we do that within this approach? That, I think, will be another very important challenge to develop the approach further. Thank you very much. I think that was what we had for you. Thank you.
Right, thank you, Katrine. Thank you, Geir, letting us more in on the whole method and the experiences we had using it and how we will develop it. Now there's a short break, there's more coffee and there's buns. So go ahead, there's a 10-minute break, and then we'll see you back in 10.
So welcome back, everyone. Hello, everybody who is on the webinar, and hi to everybody here. We've all had coffee and buns, so I'm sorry, guys, you've missed out on those. I'd like to now introduce Mette Bunting and Kaz Stewart, who are both professors working within the sphere of youth education and literacy equality. Mette is the project coordinator and is an important research asset at the pedagogy facility here at the campus. Together with Guy Moussous, she initiated the longitudinal project concerning youth realised education and dropout in Telemark. Kaz Stewart is a professor of social and health inequalities, research as wellbeing development for young people, and social justice ways of doing research. And Kaz is the principal investigator for the UK. So I could welcome you both up. Thank you.
Hello.
It's great to be here and lovely to see everybody. And it's a real privilege to have an opportunity to share some of the learning that we've gained from the last 2 years of working in this project. This session is mostly about the findings from the research, but we feel that we're still at a very early stage of having findings. So we're all, the staff and the students, are all writing journal papers and writing up our research from all of our interviews. So we don't have a view collectively as to what all of those papers say yet. But what we do have is a sense of what we found from the project based in a very powerful and informative final review conversation where all the staff and all the students got together at the end of the writing seminar and we posed ourselves the questions, so what do we know? Mm-hmm. And so what do we do with that knowledge? And so we're glad to share that with you today.
And I'm just going to give the brief agenda, the overview of what we're going to do for the next half an hour. We have developed a conceptual framework, which is the basis of the models we will develop to do with higher education and at secondary school or school in general. And it's called equality literacy. So that's an exciting concept, I think. And then we see that the findings so far that we have in higher education and to do with school, whether it's primary school or lower or upper secondary school, we see that there is similar findings that we find that might be expressed differently, whether it's a higher education or in school. And the implication might be different, but the basis, the focus, is a lot of the same. So we will present you that for you. And then we would like to bring this further on to future research, you know, what we want to sort of look more into. And we want also to look at implication. We want to draw it, well, so what? Suggestions, how to achieve change. So that is important for us as well to think not only on the research, but what does this say about schools, higher education and society?
In September 2018, I guess it was, when we first met, we had a huge range of challenging and fraught conversations about what this project was about and who we would be doing the research with. And could we really go into schools and ask for marginalised young people to come forward and talk to us? Could we go into a school setting and say, hey, has anyone dropped out? We really want to know all the people in this society who've dropped out. You know, and we questioned how we could go about that and how we could look into this issue, because we were all very passionate about helping and supporting people and from preventing this being an ongoing issue. And through those conversations, we came to think about the fact that this is in relationship to privilege. So deprivation and marginalization, you know, the circumstances of school dropout and early school leaving only exist in relation to a world where there's a huge amount of privilege and advantage and people doing well and people having opportunities. So we have to understand the two in relation to one another. So that was our first thinking. So actually we've talked to all sorts of young people, and all sorts of young people have experiences of marginalization and disadvantage, and also all sorts of experiences of privilege and advantage. Even young people who have dropped out have some instances of advantage and success in their lives. So it's important to understand all of that. So we pulled this together in the first year into a model that we called equality literacy to help us understand, to help us be literate in the equality and inequality that people were experiencing in school. And we're really keen to see at the end of this year, when we look at all the articles and all the data, to see whether this still holds true, because we designed this model purely theoretically from the first year of conversations. So this is brief, but we'll signpost you to a paper where you can read more if you'd like to. So we see that young people are born into a context. They're born into a certain place, whether that's Blackpool in England, whether that's Porsgrunn in Norway, or whether that's Aarhus in Denmark. You know, they're born there, they have no choice over that. And they'll be born into a certain household, into a certain time, and they'll go to a certain school, which they may or may not have choice over. And that creates a reaction. That, you know, they have a lived experience of being in that place. They might find it lovely and enjoyable and uplifting, or they might find that living in that situation is really oppressive and difficult and hard work. So they have a lived experience that we're trying to understand through these indirect conversations. In those situations, we also realise that young people, ourselves, are then positioned by the other people around them. So for example, some of the examples that Catherine gave us, the young people were saying that they felt as if some of the teachers liked them, you know, and that they were given more privileges and more lenience if they were liked. So there's a positioning there, whether you're likeable or you're not likeable, and that then has an impact on what you're allowed to do and who you are. The term early school leaver positions the young person as the or the dropout term positions them as the person who does the dropping out and the failing. Okay, so we understand that these positionings happen. And sometimes it's a positioning as being a school success, the bright one, the lovely one, the chirpy one, the kid that everybody likes, which gives them some liberation. So we try to think about all the different ways in which this happens, the labelling, the stereotyping, the ignoring, the silencing, the putting to one side. All of these things can raise one group of people up and give them privilege and push another group of people down and oppress them or marginalise them. Whoops. And then people react to that in certain ways. So I might have had a really poor experience of school and had teachers put me down and belittle me and stereotype me, and I have a choice then to go, oh yes, that's who I am, and to comply with those messages, or I could be really feisty and rebellious and go, hey, you know what? I'm going to show you. I can be different to what you think. So we have a response, a reaction as well. And ultimately, those together create a final trajectory, which is ever-changing and ever-shifting, but it creates a path that we're walking down and creates an outcome that we're likely to achieve. And from the stories, I think we've understood a lot about how this system contributes to the trajectory of early school leaving or dropping out. But that's not just the young person being at fault. And so we've explored this as a project team. We did an exercise in a room like this with all sorts of pieces of paper, and we all mapped our own experiences of marginalisation and privilege to understand just where we're coming from. And to be able to understand just how difficult it might be for young people to tell some of these tales that we were hoping they might tell us, even though we weren't going to directly ask them about it.
Mm. Okay. So I recommend you to look at that the paper. It's also a link on the website as well, if you don't catch it just now. Well, after the conversation we had with the students when we were in Britain after the whole week, where we were reflecting and talking about the project. We sort of have the preliminary findings or implication for higher education, but as I said earlier, also for the schools and the wider services for young people. Because this is not only teachers here, it's also youth worker, social worker, that's part of the project. It's interdisciplinary. And a lot of them are already working or have worked or have been in part of the training in the different jobs. So we are building this on that. So we found then that we wanted to, there's 5 points. The one is a support professional, student-centered, relational, radical pedagogy, and governance. So here it goes. So what will be exciting now for the next year is to explore this and see if you find perhaps even more or perhaps in a different way. But so far, what the dialogue between the between the people employed at the university and the students, we find that they talked about we have to make teachers and practitioners have time for, we have to make sure about the time, because a lot of them are feeling as a pressure of time of, they want to be more with the young people, they want to follow them up, but it's a squeeze with everything that needs to be done. And it's different from the different countries, but we see there is a trend all over Europe, at least in the 3 countries, but this seems to be something that's not just for our 3 countries. This is about being able to talking about teaching and learning, not only teach and expect them to learn, but actually have time to talk about teaching and learning. And I think when it comes to the MaCE project, that is one of the things we had plenty of time to, is to talk to students about learning. Because we had this in-between breaks, we have, for instance, we could have a coffee, and then somebody could come up to me, I didn't quite understand this. I didn't go away to have my coffee, I had my coffee with the students, because the whole point is that we do this together. It's not me coming in and visiting the students, or Cass doing that, it's something we are there as a body, we are all together about it. So the opportunity to ask questions or to be together, of course, in the teaching environment, but also in between, the in-between moments is important as well. But obviously, if we want students and pupils to learn and develop an understanding of their own learning, they need time to digest and to be in dialogue. Reflection on practice. And that is one thing when they also were exercising, when we were doing it together, but also, for instance, in the field, if we have a possibility for some of the experienced researchers to be with the students, then they could actually discuss while they practice it. And it's the same principles actually in the school. Instead of just instruction, you are supposed to do this, that, and the other. We have the possibility to discussing their experiences and seeing, well, why did it go, did it work well? Why did it work well? Bring a theory to practice and vice versa. And I think there are examples from the two sessions before. You have seen that we have tried really to bring these things together, not only in the practice of, for example, the interview situation is one thing, but to try to have exercises, playful exercises, where you don't only use a language, but you have to work in groups, you have to use your body, you have to draw, you have to put or express yourself, makes you have to think about it differently in from different perspectives, and it helps you to understand the theoretical part better. And this is about making teaching of the profession sustainable, that it can be an overload where it sort of tires the professionals to that is so much to do, or so many things that are expected to do, so the things we mentioned before here is sort of pushed out, and people trying to include everything is also a danger. And then make environments student-centered. And of course, that is the heart of of the project. But also, when in the schools, when you look at learning, that is, learning is when it actually happened at the student, with the students, it's not me teaching. And of course, it's being meaningful and relevant. And I think that what Geir and Katrine talked about before, you know, the indirect approach and how they were training beforehand, as well as Sitz and David told about, it's they had to be interviewed and experience being interviewed on as to for somebody else to train, but to be the one being interviewed does something with you next time when you also interviewed, because then you have to tie together experience and you and the theory together, and it's a different reflection as well. And about this matching the strength and the needs of the young people, students, how are you supposed to do that if you don't know them? And the way we work with the students, we get to know them in a different way. I can't say I know all my students, but I know them more than I used to do, just being together. And this is about flexibility. I don't know about everybody else's jobs, but sometimes I find that we're making rules to make the wheel go around, but sometimes perhaps the rules stops the flexibility. And if we have a lot of different students, how can we apply the same rule to everybody? I don't know if you have anything to add, Cass?
Great.
I've covered all the points so far. And this is something we also have discussed because we had this transnational meeting now two or three days, and the most obvious thing is relationships, but it's not at the same time obvious because it always comes up, both in interviews with young people struggling at school and also with students. Relationship, the relational approach is so important. And of course, it's a lot of focus, at least in Norway, in the schools, but perhaps not enough in higher education to build a relationship with the student and the student group, and how important that is. In that sense, you can also create a wide and rich support network. It's easy also for the student to approach you when you feel that you have a relationship with the lecturer. They don't just come in and out. So this is I think, sort of one of the most important subjects or focus in the project, is that working this way has enabled us to develop the relationships with the students without actually becoming friends, but it's so much easier for them to access us and ask questions, and it's so much easier for me to perhaps understand a bit more about each of the students because I know them a little bit more. So this one of the points, allow teachers, practitioners to be human, not on in a distant, just being called a professor, but I'm actually Mette, and I'm working with the students. And that we treat all people with equal respect. I don't treat Cass in a certain way, and then the student comes and I treat them a different way. We treat them with equal respect. And in that sense, we can work individually and, of course, collectively. A lot happened collectively, but I think a lot of people felt they were seen individually as well. Okay, Cass, I think next one is yours.
Thanks. So many of these points we understand through educational theory that we've used for years. You know, we know that person-centred, student-centred approaches have been around. You know, Carl Rogers has talked about them for many decades. And we know that, for example, here, practical, experiential, informal ways of learning, you know, that dates back to Dewey and Kolb and some of the great educational theorists. But it feels like the context that we work in at the moment is making this a radical pedagogy. It shouldn't be. It's a normal pedagogy that we all understand and we know well. So we're not proposing anything new, but we're proposing that we need to reclaim this space. We need to reclaim our professionalism as practitioners, whether we work in social services, whether we're teachers, whether we're lecturers. We have to reclaim this space and work in ways that we know intrinsically and that we know have been evidenced to be really powerful in the learning process. So through the discussions with students, from their discussions or our discussions with school pupils, we understood that things that helped people learn were practical, experiential and informal. And those were some of the ways in which we'd learnt in this project, and there were some of the things that school kids said they were missing in their high school experiences. There is a definite sense of mismatch that schools did not talk to young people in terms of who they are and what their experiences of the world were. As kids felt as if they came into school, they were told to sit down, wear a uniform, be a mass, a homogeneous mass, and just listen and soak up information. That's not culturally sensitive. It doesn't respect who people are or where they come from. And we know ways of working around that. We all had a sense through our experiences that we needed to balance the social and the academic. Your knowledge gains is important, but so is the social space. So we've mentioned several times the in-betweenness and the importance of those interactions. So, you know, how do we put that back into education? Where do we create that wriggle room in a packed curriculum? Support is really important, getting the right level of support. And we've talked a lot in the project about, you know, treating everyone the same, that principle of equality, but more importantly, the principle of equity, of having an equitable practice which gives more support to the people who need more support, or supporting people in different ways to respect who they are and what their different strengths and assets are. We felt that doing exercises like the equality literacy framework gave us all opportunity to unpack and explore what might be happening, what might have happened in our own lives, and to talk about some of the things that might be playing out in this project. You know, it gave us a language and a vocabulary to be able to put the inequality and the marginalisation and the power games on the table, rather than always being that out of sight, unmentionable thing that we don't talk about. So we'd advocate for dealing with this stuff explicitly. And giving each other and the young people that we work with time to critically explore the world, to ask challenging questions, to not have so much content that we just talk at them and then send them out of the door. And that was one of the richnesses and one of the privileges of this project, was having that time to question and think and challenge and explore. And of course, fun has to be part of it. I think we often forget, or we're often too busy delivering all the deliverables, that we overlook the importance of fun in the learning process. And I've certainly had an amazing amount of fun in the MaCE project. In terms of governance, we're viewing governance through the lens of, what was the name of the museum we went to in Aarhus? Aarhus Museum. So yeah, the top of Aarhus Museum, there's an incredible circular corridor. And the corridor has all the colours of the rainbow that goes around it. It was quite an experience to view the world through seven different colours. It was a really useful metaphor for the project, really clearly having a different lens on the world and how that shaped what you saw. Governance, for me at the moment, is a bit of a red light issue. It troubles me deeply. So, you know, how do we tackle this new public management issue? How do we reduce the control and increase our professionalism? You know, when practitioners felt that we all felt in the room that this was an issue we needed to tackle, decreasing the focus on statistics, you know, and getting into a different domain is really important. And young people reported how they disliked testing, they felt pressurized, you know, it was all about what they could next achieve or meeting expectations. It wasn't about being a human being. It was about performing. Funding was a constant theme, particularly in the UK. We're experiencing a lot of cuts at the moment and pullback of money. So resourcing was a theme that came out. And constantly that, you know, the new public management tends to go, you know, what are the young people doing wrong? Because we've got a really great service, even though we're pulling money out of it. And we want to try and change that conversation to what's wrong with our schools that they're failing so many young people. What's wrong with our social services that we still have so many young people in need? And if we can grab that conversation and raise it up, then we might do something to change society at large. And radically, I think this was yours, Debbie. Is this your statement? That we need to pursue and sue people who use education and youth for inappropriate means. And we might hear some of examples of that from Michelle, who has done just this very kind of work. So lots to do. Are you going to talk about this one?
Well, it's we could both talk about it, but we want to this increase core research. And one thing is what we do exactly in the project, but there's many ways to do it. And I think we have to investigate and not say, well, I don't have the resources, it's too much to do. Because it gives you so much. It gives you so much back, and see how can we manage to do that. And I think we also got some wonderful examples from Michelle about how this participative research can be done. And we think also about the increasing the user indirect approach across the services. How can this way of interviewing, talking, conversation to young people to get their story, the hidden story as Guy talked about, how is that possible perhaps to use that when you meet young people at work? Because do you get the story you want to hear, or do you get them their story? What about the framework, Cass? How can we use that?
I think there's all sorts of opportunities for exploring whether the framework is working or not, whether that's what we see in practice. There's opportunities to explore whether we can use it directly in teaching with in schools, whether teachers can use it, whether students can use it, all sorts of ways in which we could apply it as a research lens or which we can challenge it through research. And we have to do all of those.
Because it's obvious that what we call dropouts or early school leavers, they're not sort of one homogenous group that is all the same. And they're not based on sort of, or just the individual's fault. There's many reasons, there's many stories behind it. And we have to look at more at what's why is this happening, and why, what is happening on the structural way of looking at it. What is the sort of processes going between these young people and the schools? And why is perhaps some young people dropping out when others with the same challenges manage to complete? And instead of saying there's something wrong with them, well, perhaps we should point the finger back a bit at about the organization or how we perhaps are not able to meet them. So it's we also see that the early school leavers and interviews that we done, the students have done and we have done, it's a lot of other reasons, other things they struggle with in their lives. So there's just not just to increase the math teacher or something like that. It's also to look at what is, it's a complex, it's not a simple phenomenon. So we want to encourage our students and ourselves to do more research, to do that will end up in more like a social change that will matter in society.
So we've wondered a bit as a group what that social change might look like. You know, what do we do with this amazing resource? So far we have around 120 young people's stories. We have around 40 articles written about those stories. What do we do with that? So we thought about what we could do locally at a micro level, what we might do at an area level, and what we do on macro scale, kind of nationally or internationally, ever ambitious. So some ideas we came up with as a team, students and staff alike, was about, well, we need to obviously give more young people voice and help young people to make the decisions about what we do with some of this stuff, because otherwise we're just another bunch of adults making decisions on behalf of young people. So the young people need to be in this arena with us. We thought about changing our own practice. You know, we can walk our talk and put some of these ideas, some of these findings into practice ourselves and with our organisations, try and influence them. We looked at how we can take our findings back, how we can take the results of the project back and try and get people to change things where we are, and particularly in areas where there are particular issues where we can go, well, you might find this approach is helpful because we found it helped in this project. And hopefully we can stimulate some more local research. At a wider level, you know, perhaps we can talk to heads of schools, we can talk to politicians locally, perhaps we can use our local press, our local media to get some of these messages out, to change the stories that are told about young people, to change the ways in which we describe education, learning and development. Perhaps we can influence our sector, so we can talk to social workers if we work in that area, we can talk to fellow teachers, we can present at conferences, we can write in practice magazines to try and get a critical mass of people who all also want change. And it's also about community leaders, you know, the important people who can activate and stimulate change in a local area. We had a shorter list of what we could do nationally.
So far.
we're all ears later on. We talked about petitioning and lobbying. You know, we have the means. There are all sorts of online or face-to-face ways in which we can lobby and petition to try and get change to happen. We might apply for further funding. So there's an Erasmus Plus funding to enable projects to try and affect change at a policy level. So we're very interested in what that might look like. Cole, I think, said, become a politician. You know, so if we are really passionate about trying to achieve the change we want to see, then maybe we have to seek positions of power ourselves to enable that to happen, if we're so disenfranchised with those who are in power. But we'll be really glad to hear your ideas as to how we can make some of this really important work, the really important voices of young people make a difference, and to hear ideas from Michelle too around and get some inspiration from her work about how change has been possible.
Because I think you can say that when the young people share their hidden stories with us, it carries a responsibility. And we can't just publish either or articles, whether you're a student or whether you're a researcher or you're employed. It's a responsibility to give them the voice further and to do something about it.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mette and Cass. It's nice to hear some results from the project and also promise of action. So we're going to have lunch in 20 minutes, but before that we're going to hear from some of the co-researchers at this project. It's two master students, Maria Möllerskau, and also my co-researcher, co-presenter and researcher, Deborah Tarras. Maria, she's an experienced primary school teacher, and she's now in the very final weeks of writing her master's thesis. Her field of interest is aesthetics experience and how these may affect our daily life and our well-being. And when it comes to Deborah, or Debbie amongst friends, she's got 25 years of experience as a youth worker. And she's got really great organizing skills, which she uses in her everyday work of supporting the development of the civil sector in England to increase action and impact. Right, so welcome. The floor is yours.
Hello, my name is Maria. I am 35 years old and I live in Porsgrunn's neighbor town, Skien. I'm educated as a teacher and I've been working in a Norwegian primary school for 10 years. And I've been teaching children from about 9 years to 13 years old. And 2 years ago I became a master student in pedagogy, and the last year I've been so lucky to join MaCE as a co-researcher while I've been with my master thesis. It has been really been a great experience for me to be a co-researcher in MaCE, to join something that feels meaningful, that might affect and causes changes in the school system, and made it easy to engage in this project. When I became a co-researcher in MaCE, it felt like I wasn't just a student writing my thesis for my own sake, but a participant in something that felt important, that could mean something to someone. And despite of the frames that MaCE have about marginalization in the school system, I have been able to work quite independent with my own thesis. This means that I could choose my own team as long as it was relevant for the project. And it's been a good balance between being independent and having some guidelines. And as a student, I got the opportunity to do research interviews with an indirect approach. And I think it was a challenging task because I had to step back and let the youth tell their stories in their own ways. And I realized that as a teacher, I'm quite used to lead the conversation and to give advice. So I think it was, I had to think about what my role was in this interaction and find a new way to have a conversation with them. Since I got this opportunity to conduct interviews, not just read through interviews that some researcher had done, I think I learned a lot. As an example, I remember the first time I was doing an interview, I got really emotional because of the story that came up and the fact that this young boy wanted to share a sad and quite beautiful story about his life with me. and it made me feel quite unprofessional. And I wasn't sure if it was okay to become emotional like that. So I discussed it with the other co-researchers, and I got a lot of new perspectives. And in this way, I felt I learned a lot about my experience, but also from the other reflection from the other students. And I also it made me realize that there are so much toxic knowledge that you just have to experience for yourselves. Since we have been on two seminars and gathered through online sessions and workshops, we have developed an equal learning environment. Especially when we were gathered in England for the writing seminar, we had the opportunity to get in contact with our supervisor and the other teachers as well, to ask questions, to discuss and reflect with them. And different social activities and tasks that made us cooperate with each other and the teachers made it really easy to communicate and to talk to them. And it also feels like it's been an equal relationship between the master and the bachelor students. I cannot speak for the bachelor students, and since I'm a master student myself, I don't know if I'm not sure if they feel the same, but I have had the feeling that the bachelor student and the master students have been cooperated through the whole process. So despite of what kind of position or degree you have, whether you are a master or a bachelor student or a teacher or a professor, it feels like we all have been doing the same. And I think that is a positive element of the project. And during the project, we have learned something from each other. I have learned a lot from the teachers. I now know a lot about marginalization in society and the school system that I did not know about a year ago. And I also learned a lot about research and ethics. But I also think that the teacher learned a lot from the students since they got the opportunity to follow us through our work. So the relationship between us gave them some ideas of what we had experienced through our interviews, what we thought was difficult, and what it's like to be a brand new researcher on the first day of work. I think the teacher and the supervisor have done a great job adjusting their academic language and to make the research manageable for me as a student. We have been doing a lot of different activities. For example, we had these puzzle games as an introduction of coding the interviews. We weren't doing this because it was fun, of course it was, but it was a way to highlight how we can make a picture out of our research from many pieces. And this approach made it easy to understand and apply in my own work. I really liked the idea of working across nation, learning more about school system in different countries, and it made me realize that despite of the differences, there are a lot of similarities. And I never would have had this insight like I have today if it hasn't been for all the group discussions and the reflections and lessons that represent the three different nations. And I guess that people in Norway, like myself, I used to think that we have this fantastic welfare system and a fantastic school system and that we are in some leading position. But this year made me realize that we have the same problems that exist in other countries, like UK and Denmark. And it's not enough that most of the children get through school, and we have to reach them all. I think it's been interesting to be part of a group consisting of several professions because of the different perspective on marginalization in the school system. And because of my background as a teacher, I also have been challenged to have a more critical view on how school works. But at the same time, I have experience from teaching that also helped me to have some kind of realistic view on what it's like to be a teacher. And I think it has been helpful to have something to rely on. The project has also challenged me in other ways. I have been forced to speak English, and I realized that it's not so scary after all.
No.
So I look back at this year and I feel a little bit braver because I am standing here and telling you this.
but I also feel a little bit wiser because, but when you learn more, you also realize that there are so many things you don't know anything about. And I feel a little bit sad because it happens fast and now the experience is soon over. Yeah.
Well done.
That's your turn.
Is it working? No? Well done. I don't know. Is it working? No, sorry.
Okay, try.
Hello? Ah, okay. Hi. I've come from a bit of a different perspective about why I chose to embark on an international project. So for me, I was in a different position. I had just stepped down as a director of a community interest company, which is a not-for-profit organisation in the UK. So I was within a position where I was unemployed through my own fault. I chose that route. And I was actually looking back at what my education could be. I started back up again doing my MA, which I started 7 years ago. And I had an opportunity to reflect and look at where I was. And I was very fortunate to receive an email from Steve from University of Cumbria who said, "Hey, Debs, we're doing this project. Would you like to be part of it?" And I just went, "Wow, yeah, that would be great." But I was absolutely terrified because for me, it was completely out of my comfort zone. And it was working alongside peers from Norway and Denmark. I can barely speak Norwegian. I'm just being taught that now and I've not attempted Danish yet. So I just thought, how do I communicate with my colleagues? But for me, the MaCE project excited me. And I thought, as a youth worker, I need to step out of my comfort zone. I expect that too many times for the young people I work alongside, so why shouldn't I expect that from me? So I emailed back to Steve and went, okay, and wrote a little bit, and then he said, "Yes, you're on." So then I had to tell my husband because I hadn't told him. Sorry, I'm not going back to work just yet. I'm going to be doing this for a while. So the MaCE project, it excited me. It appealed to me and to my traits for exploring the unknown and also taking a bit of a risk. For me, it allowed me to be part of a co-created learning and an appreciation between myself as the student, the young people, and also the lecturers and the universities. And I would very much highlight what everybody has said, that there was never power relationships at all. Everybody was very much equal, and what we really enjoyed as students was actually we saw our tutors learning from us as well, and that was really important. It allowed me the opportunity to be part of an action research project and to apply the indirect approach. And again, that challenged not just my comfort zone, but my professional zone as well. As a youth worker, we are very much around facilitating that conversation. And as somebody from the northeast of England, I had to learn to shut up and listen, which was quite difficult as well. But it also supported my thirst for knowledge and to work in collaboration with my fellow peers. And I feel so privileged that I've had the opportunity to meet not just my peers within the UK, but my peers in Denmark and Norway as well. And I've really enjoyed that journey. But it also excited me. I say it's exciting because I'm trying to encourage more people to do this. It excited me as well because I was able to challenge some of the acid-based discourse that surrounds young people and to also embrace the risk and to try something new. But it also allowed me to be part of a process. We talked about young people telling their stories, but for me, it developed into so much more. They actually became living libraries. So we talk about with older people and we ask them, "Tell us your journey. How was it like to grow up, 60, 70 years ago?" And some of those stories are lost, whereas I think with the young people today, they became living libraries. So it was like you go to a library, I'll choose that young person, and they told your story. But again, you had to be quiet because you're in a library and you had to listen to what they were saying. So that was really important. So for me, just to put in a bit of a context why I wanted to be part of the MaCE project, it wasn't just because I was unemployed. I had nothing much to do apart from my MA. I come from a small seaside resort called Blackpool, which is in the northwest of England. And we have approximately 140,000 people. And out of those 140,000 people, 7,000 of the children are actually in low income. Families, and we are in one of the, if not the most deprived area in the whole of the UK. So every time our government do statistics, Blackpool comes out on top of everything. everything. We heavily rely on a tourist industry. So we have what you call a winter benefit culture in Blackpool, where you'll have second, third, four generations of families who will work within the tourist season, which is February to November. Then in November, you'll go back onto benefits again, because we have a lot of zero-hour contracts. So within our families and with regards to the young people, in terms of their social mobility, that's quite restricted, because a lot will just rely on a tourist industry rather than actually looking at much more other industries that are within Blackpool, but a lot of people will just see it as a tourist. The exam results, unfortunately, again, we are always topped as the lowest in the whole of the UK. And while some of our young women are outperforming some of the young men within Blackpool, we still have a deficit model when those young women are actually then going on and progressing around their social mobility. They may be getting better exam results, but when that comes to employment, something's happening there. So we very much have what we call the sticky floor, or the people might call it the glass ceiling, but we definitely do have that in Blackpool. And also, when I talk about social mobility, we found that the young people that we interviewed, it was very apparent across it all. So with regards to the six young people that I interviewed, all of them had chosen quite non-traditional educational routes. They'd all left school with very poor experiences, but they were now within a football club academy, so they were actually being trained by tutors within a football club. And I found that quite interesting, that they'd continue education, but they kind of turned on the traditional methods of further education. So some of the common themes that came from my results were teachers see results, not human beings, and they all felt like that. Some extreme bullying, and I think as a youth worker in Blackpool, that very much what Marie said, I came from that very much affected by that, because the extreme bullying that was happening within the schools and the teachers still allowing that to happen was quite extreme and very intimidating. Lack of opportunity and restriction in social mobility for a lot of them. There was a band-aid, like a sticky plaster approach. So it seemed to be there was the cut, put the sticky plaster on and everything was all right, but it certainly wasn't. We talked about positioning before and about how the schools and the teachers and their peers actually positioned those young people depending on what group they were in or what circle of friends. But also what I found very interesting was the lack of respect and acknowledgement that young people felt they didn't get from the school. And so they were actually asking, they were demanding for respect, but they didn't get that from their teachers. And I found that quite sad to have that. A lady called Sonia Blanford came to Blackpool to try and not fix us, but to try and support in terms of how we can develop Blackpool. And she'd said that we know when children and young people don't achieve what they're capable of achieving, that it does have a long-term legacy effect on society. And that's certainly what I'm finding now as part of this research. One of the young people that I interviewed actually had 11 teachers in 1 year for English. And she just said, I couldn't get that relationship. So was it any wonder that I couldn't pass the exam, because I didn't have a relationship? So I think 11 teachers, if we'd had 11 tutors doing this, would we still be able to stand here today? So just about putting it into perspective. But finally, for me, I think the lived experience of the young people that I've had the privilege to interview and to listen to, their stories and their lives, just had one common voice and one call to action. And that was, please just give us all good, equitable teaching. That's it.
Thank you, Maria. Thank you, Debbie, for sharing your experiences as co-researchers. And now it's time for lunch. So a 30-minute lunch, and then we meet back again at 12. And there's lunch served back at the top of the stairs.
Okay, so welcome back, everyone. Thank you for a lovely lunch again. Apologies those on webinar, but we have had a very nice lunch. I would like to now have the pleasure of introducing our distinguished professor, Michelle Fine, from the University of New York. Is that correct? Michelle's work addresses theoretical questions of social injustice that sits within the intersection of public policy and social research, particularly with respect to youth in schools and criminal justice. Michelle's research interest goes hand in hand with the research philosophy here at MaCE. Michelle has vast experience in participatory action research and studies of social injustice and resistance, particularly in the context of urban education. And through the years, Michelle has contributed to generate and spread knowledge and awareness of children and young people's experiences in school, and her observation of how the school system is silencing and framing students that don't fit into the social and cultural categories preferred by schools. So, welcome.
So is this, yeah, good. And hello everybody in webinar land. So thank you, Mete and Kaz in particular, for welcoming me. And it was a pleasure to listen to all of the talks this morning and learn with you and from you. You know, usually in the United States, I start with honoring the stolen land upon which we stand. But I don't need to do that here in Norway, I guess. Or maybe I do, and we'll need another conversation. And I also acknowledge all the violence global that the United States has contributed to historically and currently. So I know none of us is outside of that, and some of us are more vulnerable than others, which is not unrelated to the work that I think we all do. So I am honored to be here, and I think that I'm going to do a couple of things that I didn't anticipate, having listened to all of you and also realizing we have a lot of time together. I think I'll draw from some videos that we've created with young people, and for those of you here as well as in the world, you can find all of these videos at the Public Science Project, which is where all of the research that I will speak about comes from. One of the commitments that I and we make is that we think a lot about to whom is our work responsible. That is, to whom do we respond, but to whom are we accountable? And if I were teaching, I would ask you all to write a letter. To whom is your work responsible? Is it the child you taught in third grade that you know you didn't reach? Is it some great-grandparent who didn't have the opportunities you have? Is it a young person in juvenile or detention centers in your country or mine who's probably not on the webinar right now? I don't think that we have the luxury, I probably never thought this, but I don't think right now we have the luxury of research for research's sake. So I bring to this a set of passion and urgency. I invite you all to come visit me in the United States, and you will see why we feel passionate about sprawling inequalities, what we call white supremacy, what we call the greed and grotesque consequences of unbridled capitalism, gentrification, immigration, violence. We are living with it very up close, and while I live a very privileged life and get to come over here and chat with you about it, lots of people I love are either locked up in prisons or in detention camps or in lives that feel like both, even though they have freedom. So in addition to thinking about to whom we are responsible, we spend a lot of time thinking about, like, who are we? Who's this white woman in the United States who's about to talk to you about a lot of young people, many of whom don't look like me? So I'm going to do a really brief autoethnographic look. So I am the youngest child of my mother, Rose, who was the youngest of 18. My family were Jewish immigrants from Poland who left in the 20s, my dad an orphan, and as I said, my mom was the youngest of 18. She left me a few years ago, but she was 4'8", all breasts. I don't know if they make them here in Norway, but they really made them in Poland. Adorable, had no idea what I did for a living, but probably knew me better than anyone has. And I was her baby. And my parents came here, at a moment that historians have called when the Jews became white. And again, I realize our contexts are very different, but it was a moment in the history of the United States when white immigrants were coming, Italian, Mediterranean, Irish, Jewish, and it was a struggle. But there were a set of policies put in place that said, come to our country. We will support you. You'll be in the military. You'll then get help with housing. You'll get help with schooling. And eventually, those of us who were white could assimilate some. The rise of the neo-Nazis in the United States have reminded those of us who are Jewish that that assimilation thing didn't totally work out. Because some people are still making terrifying distinctions. But having been raised in that household, I think I grew up with a view from the critical margins. That is, I understood that the dominant story that society in the United States was telling about itself was not the only story that could be told. And again, I really get it that in Norway it's quite different. I think in the UK you have some resonance to this, that the dominant story misrepresented the lives, particularly of the poorest, of the most marginalized, of people of color, and today of Muslim Americans, of Native Americans, of immigrants. I grew up in a house where my father was... He sold plumbing supplies, and he would go out to America every day and become American. And my mother held the sadness and was depressed and lay in bed. And so I grew up knowing that sadness or depression and radical optimism live in the same house. And in fact, they sleep together. And maybe they need each other. And that informs my sense of the ways in which our privilege is related to the dispossession of others. And maybe we need to sleep together. Maybe we need to share stories to understand these aren't separate populations. They are a group of people who have profited from the world, the same police that welcome me every morning. I then hear about how they treat the young people of color that I work with every evening, and I think of them as so trustworthy. And I have three sons, two white and one African-American, foster care, C-sections, figure it out. They have very different relations to the police, to public institutions, to trust, to Demetrius, who's African-American, is like, why do you always smile at people, right? My two white sons mostly just smile at people also. They walk in a room, expect the world to respond, right? And it mostly does. So I've been dedicated to looking at how does dominant society look from the radical rim? And I actually think there's a lot of wisdom and knowledge at the radical rim about life at the rim, but also about the center. Does that make sense? It's not just that the people you're interviewing know about their own lives. They know a lot of things about the hidden transcripts of dominant society, right? The things that we don't want other people to know. So for about 30 years, I've spent glorious time chatting with school pushouts, dropouts, early school leavers. We can talk about how this research really forces us to think about what are the assumptions and the categories we use. We used to call them dropouts, but that kind of focused on them. Pushouts is a little too simple in the other direction. Early school leavers might be descriptive, but it doesn't have a bite. I hang out, do a lot of research with women in prison. I'm happy to chat with you about any of this. Muslim American young people and young people who would call themselves queer, lesbian, gay, bi, trans, inquiring, asexual, as well as lots of other kinds of young people. I feel like that's what gives me the sense of optimism in a really hard world, working with young people who are living in circumstances very different than my own, who are still funny and activist and pissed off and generous, all in one, right? But that then makes me draw theoretically to arguments people like David Harvey, Ignacio Martín Baró, Gloria Anzaldu are happy to give you more details. But I'm always looking at the relationship between dispossession, that is the way the state and corporations are dispossessing some communities of extractive practices, and privilege, and resistance. And for me, that's the magical trifecta. I don't want to just look at the damage done to a community without understanding that somebody else is profiting. Like right now in the United States, it's not like a big secret that some people are paying a price and a very, very small group of people is profiting grotesquely, right? But you also need to know that there's a ton of resistance. And it's not winning at the moment, but it's alive and it's mobilizing. And maybe we need to think of that as like waves, like in your fjords, and eventually the boat will topple. But probably not today, although I keep checking my phone to see if the boat toppled. Not yet. But I'm also interested, as Guy mentioned, in silencing and desire. That is, not just attending to the voices that are loudest, that are speaking, that are most pained or most assimilated, but the voices that my mother held, the ones that were in bed that were maybe silent with, in Yiddish you would call it a shmata on her head, like a wet rag on her head, and desire, like what did she yearn for? And I feel like so much of our work is organized around desire. And we try not to do what we call damage-centered research, which means focusing on how broken people are by injustice. And this might be an ethical, epistemological conversation to have, because on the other hand, you don't want to sugarcoat that injustice has real consequences. But partly because of youth organizing, it's clear to me that representing people only by how broken they are is actually neither true nor a great way to garner respect or resources. Somehow in psychology and in education, we have unfortunately assumed that the only way to prove injustice is to prove that someone's broken. And I think we need to decouple that. We need to understand that there's injustice and people ache, they're wounded, but they thrive and they make love and they make humor and they make families, even in tents, even on the streets, even under a bridge. Okay, I'll get to some of the others. But I studied with a woman named Maxine Green. If you don't know her, go home and read her. She was a very, very good friend, much older than I. She was an existential philosopher who worked with John Dewey. And she and Dewey distinguish between aesthetic experiences and anesthetic experience. So you all know what anesthesia is, right? How do you feel when you're under anesthesia? You're out of it. You're numb. You can walk past homeless people outside my office and not see them. And they worried that schools were organized around anesthetic experience. And they argued that instead we should be organizing research and art and schooling around aesthetic experiences. And so many, you know, your slides from this morning were aesthetic slides. They were sensual. You could smell them, you could feel them. And I actually think that's what learning is. There's something weird about us saying, and then we found like it's a mining expedition. And then we found the gold. Oh my God, relationships matter. That maybe we need to reconsider knowledge production as the praxis and not then there's a finding. I don't know. There's just listening to you all this morning about these thick aesthetic experiences and then thinking, you know, we have this linear model that says, and here's the result, right? As opposed to if you think of the most glorious moment in your life, it's not a result. It's a smell, it's a flower, it's an encounter. Anyway, to be continued. And in the work that we do, which is always participatory, and I'll get to that in a moment, we are dedicated, as you suggested this morning, to working through power inequities, to looking at the contradictions, the fissures. What do people know Gloria Anzaldúa? After you read Maxine Green, read Gloria Anzaldúa. She's a Chicana feminist poet, and she speaks about choques. Does anybody know Spanish? It's a word for clashes. And her argument is that we're all always in borderlands. We're in rivers with many streams, like the fjords that we saw yesterday. And some are streams of possibility, and some are bloody, and some are violent, and some are colonial, and some are hegemonic, and some are creative, and some are not yet known. And in those borderlands, like I think of schools as both very liberatory and prisons, because they're both. Right? And it's our work to extract the liberatory possibilities. But when we work across power lines, we must be dedicated to interrogating choques, clashes. And how many of you work with young people? Yeah, so at least in my country, and I think in the UK, if you're working with young people, you're in a generational contestation these days. It's called call-out culture. Do we have that in Norway? No. Okay, coming your way soon. Young people have some attitudes about the world that we have left them. They have some attitudes about, in the US, why white people are in charge of everything. They've got some attitudes about why elites are in charge of everything. And these days, they do not hesitate to tell you. So we are choques rich, right? And it's not always fun when you're in the middle of it, but they are always the most interesting moments where the research shifts, where the work alters, because there's a power struggle. So I'm going to give you some examples of the kind of work we've done. But first I'll give you our... I'm going to give you our sacred principles, and then I'll undo them all. But when I talk about critical participatory action research, this is an epistemology, not a methodology. Again, for those of you who are researchers, we use ethnography, we use large-scale quantitative, we use secondary analysis of police records with communities, secondary analysis of education, and then we do community-based surveys as well. We do focus groups and interviews and mapping. Critical PAR, participatory action research, has to do with where we think knowledge lives and who has expertise. That's the radical thing. It's that academics have one kind of knowledge, that's cool, but lots of other people who clean this building have another kind of knowledge. And my guess is the people who clean this university know more about the faculty than the faculty know about them, because that's how power works, right? So critical PAR assumes that knowledge is widely distributed, but people who have paid the most price for injustice have an acute wisdom that is essential for shaping research questions. So there's a privileging of the most marginalized point of view. Does that make sense? It's not to say the rest of us are evacuated. I don't say we do youth research where I'm just an empty. We do intergenerational work that privileges youth perspectives, particularly the most marginalized. But we also interrogate what philosopher Charles Mills calls an epistemology of ignorance, That is, those of us who are privileged don't know what we don't know. Charles Mills? No? You need something? No? Good. So an epistemology of ignorance is just that people who are privileged, we see the world in a very particular way, and we don't always know what we don't know. And we've conducted science in ways that privileges a lens that is our lens. Right? So we don't know the hidden transcripts of schooling. We don't know the hidden transcripts of resistance. There's a philosopher named Nancy Tawana who's written on epistemologies of ignorance, just doing a critical review of science on why is there no science on women's orgasms. Right? Like, why don't we decide to study that one? Right? Even in Norway, that's funny. So an epistemology, not a methodology, no research on us without us, that has been an important position of AIDS activists, of disability rights folks, of indigenous folks, the Maori in New Zealand. I cannot study other people's communities without them being deeply engaged, and I would add, without understanding how my community has exploited, extracted, supported, been in solidarity with that community. Does that make sense? In the United States, there's a lot of white researchers studying brown communities. People who live in those communities are a little sick of it. Partly because we get famous off of what some would call poverty porn. We get tenure. We get published. But also we don't represent it in the complexity that those communities would represent. So I would say it is not an ethical position to retreat, but it is to reimagine how to engage with. And that's been particularly an issue in the disability rights community, where for decades there was research by non-disabled researchers on people with disabilities. And there's a wonderful scholar, also a critical philosopher, Harlan Hahn, who had polio, who said, this research is filled with existential anxieties of non-disabled researchers. Aesthetic anxieties and existential anxieties about what's going to happen to your body. So temporarily able-bodied people, that's those of us who think we're able-bodied, they remind us we're temporarily able-bodied, should only do research with people in communities that are impacted because they know the wisdom, the knowledge, that it's not just a damage story. Does that make sense? So we create what Maria Elena Torre calls contact zones for the research. So it's kind of like your indirect method, but we have groups, research collectives, working together to figure out what's the question, what's the sample, what's the methods, what's the analysis, and what products will we create together. So these contact zones, if we're working in prison, they're half women in prison and half those of us not in prison. If we're working with school pushouts, it's half young people who have left school and half or less academic researchers. If you're going to bring people together to fully engage in the way Maria was saying and Deb, to fully engage across status, you've got to really build what we call research camps, where we share language, we share experience, we talk about if we're going to study schooling or policing, we bring in our knowledge, our music, we read academic articles together about the issue. We read newspaper articles and triple space it. And then the young people or the women who've been in prison write, what is the article trying to say between the lines? And how would you have rewritten this article? So that we get at the frame. When we do research on formerly incarcerated, you know, the United States likes to put people in prison a lot, mostly poor people and people of color. So we did a project with formerly incarcerated folks in university, and it was called The Gifts You Bring. So I show up, you're all formally incarcerated, and I say, we're going to do this project on the gifts you bring to the university. Well, just the framing, like, knocked people out. Like, don't you think I'm going to steal your bag, I'm going to rape your daughter, I'm going to, you know, rip off the university. And so the framing really matters, and that came out of work that we had done with incarcerated folks. So we create these contact zones. I'll give you a deep dive. We look at structural issues. We engage in what Lois Weiss and I have called critical bifocality. Maybe in some contexts this is more important than others, but our argument is that a life should never be studied without understanding the policy, structures, and histories that surround the life, right? So when you're looking at school leavers, it's a real downstream story. You know what I mean? Downstream. So we're looking, it's like the grandmother whose ankles are swollen. It's actually not an ankle problem, right? So we see the symptoms, but it's a coronary problem. It's the heart of the nation is suffering, and it's showing up in some neighborhoods and in some behaviors. But if we study only, if we put the aperture around that problem, we will have lost the structures that have produced that, both for the kids and for the educators who can't get to know them. Like, it's so painful always to hear gorgeous youth workers who know young people and to hear teachers only pay attention to, like, you can hear that. I've been to almost every country. You hear it in every country. So what is it about the ways we've organized schools? Teachers didn't start out wanting just to focus on the good ones. What is it that reshapes their lens? So critical bifocality simply says we need to understand structures, history, if we're going to study a life. We draw a lot from Franz Fanon. We also take seriously that knowledge is co-created in the making. It's not like you bake and then you've got a cinnamon bun. Right? It's in the baking, it's in the doing, it's in the work you're all doing. I know year three you'll have your findings, but you already know a lot, and it's already in your bodies and the bodies of people you've touched. And I sometimes worry that we don't attend enough to how knowledge travels, right? How relationships move across bodies. We're interested in intersectionality. And finally, again, all of these decisions are made collaboratively and in a participatory way. But we're interested in telling a different story than the story that's being told about the communities we're working with or about the problem we're working on. And we're interested in talking to policymakers, of course, but also to organizers and young people and the media. And we're interested in performance as well as academic articles, as well as t-shirts. When we do research on aggressive policing, the United States has very aggressive policing, particularly against African Americans. So we collect data in the community, quantitative and qualitative. And we take the qualitative data and make it into t-shirts. And in my office is a small child-sized t-shirt that says, "Why do I always fit the description?" Right, and when you have communities walking around with your data, it's a very powerful way of disseminating, probably better than sending a report to Theresa May. No doubt. All right, so I'm gonna show you two short videos. All right, yes, I need to know how to go to the video. So one will show you a group of young people after our project. Thanks. After our project, they created this video to show you why participatory research by the people most affected by structural inequity is so important. The second video is one of our community-based dissemination projects. Did you do it? We good?
Our project started in February 2008.
Over 40 youth from public schools, private schools, detention centers, foster homes, LGBTQ youth groups, immigration right groups, and youth organizing groups came together with educators, activists, lawyers, psychologists, researchers, and doctoral students to design a survey for high school age youth.
Polling for Justice was a participatory action research project about youth experiences of injustice in education, criminal justice, and public health across New York City.
Our goal was to collectively design a large-scale citywide youth survey to analyze the results of our survey, then interpret the data through writing and through performance.
Participation was at the heart of each part of our project.
In Polling for Justice, we combine youth knowledge and experience with other experts like teachers and researchers, academics and community leaders.
We committed to work together on every aspect of the research.
Research about adolescents often makes it look like we're the problem, but we wanted to show how public policies and institutions hurt certain communities and benefit others.
We are the ones who are impacted by public policies. Why don't policymakers ask us what we think and what we think should change?
In Polling for Justice, we did research with, not on, young people.
It's important to recognize that we have expertise too.
Together, we designed a study to better understand youth experiences of public policy.
We were young people doing research about the experiences of other young people.
And we created a performance based on our findings that starts with the question, who has the expertise?
Oh, hello. My name is Dr. Researchy Research, and I'm going to be presenting a paper to you today on the urban teen. Now, I've been developing this theory using a framework to look at the major problem that's facing the urban city centers, namely the adolescent. For the last 8 years, I did a lot of work looking at at-risk youth in New York City.
Urban teen.
Now, my study was recently published by a peer-reviewed journal of the utmost importance.
I think he's talking about you.
Now, my self-reported measures were...
I definitely think he's talking about you.
Excuse me.
I don't know what he's talking about. No one understands him but himself.
Sorry. So as I was saying, there's a direct correlation between this risky...
Well, can you just tell him to stop talking about us like we're not here?
I found that self...
Oh, wow, she's really going up there.
Excuse me, sorry. So as I was saying, there's a direct correlation between this risky...
excuse me. Can you, stop talking about us? We're sitting right here.
Excuse me, who are you?
Well, I'm an urban teen. Okay. I live my life every day, and I know what's going on.
Well, you might live it, but I've actually studied it.
Well, so. I've studied it, too.
Security, what's going on? I'm supposed to be presenting a paper here.
See, here's the problem. You're only asking certain questions and looking at particular pieces of information.
Who are you?
Well, I'm Maybelline. I'm a part of Polling for Justice.
And I'm Jessica, and I'm also from Polling for Justice.
Polling for Justice? What's that? I've never heard of that.
That's when all teens come together and do research on our lives.
Okay, I have information that shows why teens are so angry.
Hi, I'm Jaquana, and also a member of Polling for Justice, and what we do is called participatory action research.
What's that? I've never even heard of that. Is that a legitimate field of study?
Yes, it's when you do research on other youth because we believe we are the experts of our own problems.
Research! Oh, research projects. Oh, that's very sweet. How old are you?
18.
Oh, you're in high school?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just graduated.
Okay, well, that's great. But I actually have my PhD, so back to my study. I found that in this study that looked at these...
Hi, I'm Darius, and I'm also a part of this whole P4J thing. And see, you might have your PhD, and that's great, but we've been studying this for a while.
Hi, I'm Niara. We are a research group that started back in February of 2008. We wrote a survey on youth experiences with criminal justice, public health, and education.
Okay, well, anyway, back to my study. I found that in the survey sample of 200 people, that...
Hi, I'm Candace, and I'm also a P4J-er.
There's more of you? Are you all part of this project?
Yeah. So between 2008 and 2009, we surveyed over 1,000 New York City youth.
We use performing arts to show our data on education, public health, and a criminal justice system, with the hopes that not only will you just listen, but you'll be inspired to take action.
Action? No, but this is research. We can't confuse what we do.
Okay, so we all have knowledge. So why don't you come take the time to listen and learn?
No, but I know what the problem is. It's that you just don't care about their future.
See, that's where you're wrong. Have you seen our study where 69% want to go to college and get a degree?
Right. And 90% feel somewhat or very hopeful about their future.
Mm-hmm. What numbers are you talking about?
Oh, wow. Do we really need to break it down for you?
I guess so.
Because we're all researchers, can I get a turn with that coat?
I think it looks good. I think I'll try it too.
Okay. I got next.
I guess so.
I think it'll look better on me though.
All right, this goes on. Let's go back to the PowerPoint, and you're so good at that. Good. Good. So a lot of times people ask us, well, did this project change them? It's a longer conversation. I'm happy to say that we're still in touch with most of the young people we've ever worked with. We've done like 30 different projects, and participatory action research is like chosen family. They just don't leave, and they come back and produce more research. And some of the, but the point is not just really to help these young people. The point is actually to create better research. So let me do the nerdy story. There's a pedagogy story in here for sure, and I'm gonna go through some of the pedagogical methods. For us, whether we're doing research in women's prisons, in communities, in schools, with young people, with intergenerational groups, there's a commitment to what Vygotsky would call the zone of proximal development for all of us. And we are enhancing what we think of as construct validity. So I'm gonna use really boring terms that maybe you've all dispensed with. We do think that we understand social constructs better when the people who are living most impoverished lives with respect to those constructs can help us understand them. So I think democracy is great. I think voting is great. Well, I would, right? I'm documented. I'm allowed to vote. Nobody challenges my vote. In the United States right now, even notions like that are up for grabs because they're not equally enacted in different communities. So construct validity is one thing we take seriously. Strong objectivity we also take seriously. I am not willing to say that my colleagues who study issues from on high, from what Donna Haraway would call a God's eye view, I'm not willing to say that they do it objectively and that this is subjective. We engage in what Haraway calls strong objectivity, which means that very differently positioned people pool their perspectives and our blind spots. And together, we create a research question and design by trying to keep our biases from blocking what's possible, but acknowledging that we all have a different part of the elephant. So we still engage in what we call strong objectivity, which is different than when we work with youth organizing groups who already know the answer to the question. They often work with us, and they're a little mixed about the research because the research is more complex than, I know there should be, you know, whatever, no police in the Bronx. And a lot of people in the Bronx want police. They just want to be not killed by the police, right? So we engage in participatory work for strong objectivity, construct validity, and what we call provocative generalizability. That is not narrowly statistical generalizability, 40% of Muslim American youth feel like their schools support them, but provocative generalizability. That is, does this research make you rethink the conditions in which you're living and working? Does that make sense? I just learned about empathetic validity as well. So this is about pedagogy, but it's also about science. And I know there was a question from Webland about evidence-based. I usually don't use the language of evidence-based because, at least in my country, that has been used as a club against practitioners, using outcomes that are usually not very meaningful to either practitioners or the people they're working with. And it's used as a shaming practice. And yet I would argue this is democratic evidence-based practice. That is, if the evidence comes from and with, in deep and hard conversations, the most impacted and most privileged communities, that's a kind of evidence I'm happy for us to grapple with. I don't want to call research done on high, funded by corporate interests in testing on schools, evidence-based. I think that's a very particular kind of framing that denies the fact that neither educators nor communities find test scores to be the best evidence of education. So I'm happy to, Jack, I know you're out there asking about this, and I'm happy to think about it. But I do feel obligated to evidence. I am nerdy enough and trained as an experimental social psychologist. So I am interested in what difference does this make and how would we know? But when we do work, for instance, with battered women's organizations, in the United States, programs only get money if the women have called the police and if they get orders of protection. You probably have different, bless you, metrics here. If you work with undocumented communities, religious communities, communities where there are co-wives, communities of immigrants who are scared of the police, communities where the police show up and take the kids away, those women aren't calling the police. So then, but we work with them to figure out what are the indicators that matter, right? So it's and you can do that. So this is not a retreat from the language of evidence-based, but it is asking whose evidence matters. All right, blah, blah, blah. All right, I'm gonna take you into two projects, one quickly and one a little more deeply. You know tapas, like Spanish restaurants, do you have them here? Yeah, like little plates, so you'll still be hungry, but you could go to the public, or write me, all of you write me. I'm very responsive on email. So there are two projects. Most of the projects that we do now, social movements come to the public science project and say, can you help us document what's going on around policing, around school closings, around high-stakes testing, around graduation requirements and school pushouts. These two projects came a little differently. Right after 9/11 in the United States, as I assume has been true elsewhere, but intensely in the United States, Muslim American young people suddenly felt like outsiders in their own communities. They had already been living in the United States as a minority group. They were not very impoverished, actually relatively middle class and white-ish, okay? Heavy on the ish. But after 9/11, they were shocked that the young people, that suddenly they were considered invaders or potential terrorists or oppressed. The women, and that they were what we would call exiles in their own country, right? So it was a double trauma to Muslim American young people because the United States suddenly became lots more Islamophobic, but also their view of Islam in their home countries, even if it was grandparents, was much more fractured, and they had to contend with Islam not just as a peaceful religion, but they now had to contend with these other dynamics within global community. Does that make sense? So it was a double. My friend Selçuk Şirin asked me to help him do some research with Muslim Americans in New Jersey. And I originally said no. I said, you know, I'm Jewish, the history of Jewish-Muslim relations has been so difficult, and particularly in Israel and Palestine, but also now in the United States, didn't feel like it was my place to then study this community. But he said, but you know how to do focus groups. And I did know how to do focus groups. And I decided it was all right if what we were studying were the structural dynamics that shifted under their feet, that I wasn't going to go into a community and say, what's it like to be Muslim American? But they became, for me, one more group where a secure attachment to a nation got severed. And that has happened to many groups in the United States, Mexican Americans, Native Americans. It happens to foster youth when they get ripped out of their homes. It sometimes happens to lesbian or gay young people when their families or churches throw them out. So that while I was going to honor the experience, I wasn't studying a group, which at least for me feels really important. And you all need to think about what enables you to wander into the communities you wander into. But I have been well schooled that other people's communities are not just low-hanging fruit waiting for me to pluck them or write about them. So I think on the Muslim American Project, I want to make two points. One is that we did a quantitative survey, as well as interviews, as well as focus groups, as well as maps. And I'm going to show you some of the maps. And we interviewed them in 2004, 5, 6, and now we're interviewing them in 17, 18, 19. But it's not the same kids. It's 14 to 18-year-olds. And I will give you the punchline, which is that in 2004 through 6, Muslim American kids in the U.S. were like, what happened? How did I get, you know, the world shifted around me. I'm an American. Why is everybody treating me like I'm an invader or an outsider? So there was some alienation, but mostly a sense that I'm very much an American. And they lived on the hyphen of their hyphenated identities. And one of the things I have noticed throughout Europe is that it's harder to live at the hyphen. Like in the United States, I am Jewish American. There are African Americans. There are Mexican Americans. There are Muslim Americans. And at that hyphen, a lot of work happens. You can be very Jewish and very American. You could be very Muslim and very American. Those aren't competing identities. They're actually like, you know, shoes and socks. It's not like you have to choose one. And yet in a lot of our countries, particularly now, we're hearing a national rhetoric of, are you Muslim or are you whatever, Danish, or are you German? So at that point, and at this point, there was a clash of civilizations hypothesis that if you were very Muslim, you couldn't be very national. Do you get what I mean? So we included that in this crazy survey to see, can you be very Muslim and very American? I think one thing the United States might do well, there aren't many things I usually say, is that we know that life at the hyphen can be delicious. People are dancing on those hyphens. And our country, other than the fact that we've enslaved people, genocide on natives, and stolen Mexican land, we are a country of immigrants. We know that's, except for current moment, we know it's a resource. We know it's a gift. We know that our country is better for that. Our language is infused with it, our food, our culture. There is no U.S. culture. And maybe that's McDonald's. I don't know what, like, U.S. culture or hegemony and war. But we are a mixture, and that it's a delicious mixture. You will see what happens after 15 years when people are told you don't belong, you don't belong, you don't belong. So I'm just going to do a quickie and then I'm going to give you the other project. So we use a lot of Edward Said. So the good news is you could be very Muslim and very American, not at all Muslim, not at all American, very Muslim, not American, not at all Muslim. That you can be right? You can be multiple. You could be a dancer and an academic. You could be a mother and a lesbian. Like, these are not the same category, all right? And it was actually really important to demonstrate that, unfortunately, that these are independent identities. Then we had people do maps, and we ended up coding the maps, and there's a methodological conversation about how to use maps. I noticed David's education, was that yours? Yeah. You know, you could code them, you could just use them to illustrate points. I don't really care, but we did code them initially. And so it was an opening. I met with these focus groups and I said, look, I got to tell you, I'm Jewish. I have a great sense of injustice about what's happening to Palestinians in the Middle East and to Arabs in this country. And all I could say is, I'm sorry. We're going to do this research together. We need your wisdom. We need to know how other Muslim American young people are navigating the United States right now. And to start, which is a little maybe like the indirect approach, it didn't start with here are my questions. I just said, draw your many selves. We hinted up, and we've done this in prison. We've done it at high-end law schools. We've done it in a variety. Just draw your many selves. Draw your sexy self, your student self, your daughter self, your son self, your athletic self, your inner self, your outer self. We just did a project with foster youth. You know, foster youth, kids who were pulled out of their biological family. And I said, who were at CUNY, and I said, you know, draw, how did you get here? Use green for what helped you, red for what got in your way, and purple for your own amazing self. And then people draw for 15 minutes. Now I'm just explaining method. And you put up a museum, and everybody does a gallery walk, and they start to, and a couple of people present theirs, and you look at some shared themes. And it's a gorgeous way of people claiming the shape and representation of their selves, rather than, are you mistreated because you're Muslim? Are you alienated because you're gay? Are you shameful because you're a school leaver? So it allows people to shape the landscape. So these are the kinds of images we got. They were really gorgeous, and again, in 15 minutes, I highly recommend this method. Everybody says, I'm not a good artist, and then you say, yeah, none of us are, and then some of them really are. So about 60% of the early maps were integrated pathways. I'm Muslim and I'm American. So you see this river with American life and Islamic life, and then you see this flower. Then a smaller percent were like parallel lives, what we in the United States would call code switching. So sometimes I'm American, sometimes I'm Muslim, I can live between the two worlds, it's okay. You know, sometimes you're a mother and sometimes you're an academic. Sometimes you're a student and sometimes you're a teacher, right? Those are two selves that we heard from Maria. So very happy with different flags. And then we got a small group who were actually representing conflict, that the hyphen was already filled with attention. Question marks, pain, split eggs. Again, these are like in 15 minutes. I promise you, try it. If you're comfortable, they'll be. If you're uncomfortable, don't try it. And this is, of course, the saddest one. And I have to say, working with young men who often don't talk in focus groups or don't elaborate, the visual methods are very powerful because you get a different, I never would have gotten the tears in a focus group. There's this might be too simple, but sometimes male focus groups can like out macho each other, like the women do a little more solidarity, grotesque sentences that I've just said, but I think the focus group operates differently with masculinity and femininity. I'm about to go into a study where the young people will kill me for having that binary, but for now. And I said, what are the tears? And he said, these are tears for racism. No surprise, the hyphen, when it's conflicted, is heavy. It's highly correlated with depression, alienation. A lot of kids talked about, are your parents paranoid? Like, my mother doesn't want me to go to college because she's afraid that something's going to happen to me. At the very end of the focus group, this is just another method. I said, if you were going to make a movie, They kept talking about American kids, even though they were American kids, and I kept correcting them, but I was clearly wrong. They no longer felt like American kids. So I said, all right, if you were gonna make a movie for American kids, what would, like an MTV, like a kids movie? So most of them were about educating others. Some were about challenging, you know, young women would take their cell phone and shove it under their hijab and say, look, I'm hands-free, or no, I don't shower in it. And the boys would say, I'm not a terrorist. And lots of, we're just normal. And then about 10% on, this is really hard. And I didn't know that you thought of me this way. Since Trump, hate crimes are way up. If I talked to a group this size recently at a community college near where I live, and it was filled with Muslim American young people. And I said, how many of you have experienced either verbal or physical, in New York City, kids, young people can have their hijab pulled off, or people say stuff, and almost every hand went up. And then I said, how many of you have told a teacher? How many of you have told the police? How many of you have told parents? These are young people who really don't want to upset their parents, and so they're holding it, right? We talked last night about whether your kids tell you their sorrows, but they're holding it because they don't want their mothers and fathers suffering even more. And they're holding them, the daughters are holding it because they don't want their mothers and fathers telling them they can't go outside. But the images are very different today. Two things have changed. One is most of the Muslim American young people that we talk to today identify as people of color, not as white people. They're very allied with the struggles of African Americans, Latinx folks. They have grown up under Islamophobia. They don't trust police, they don't trust teachers. Why would they, right? That's really different. It's like a pre-post design in some nerdy science experiment where, like, before Islamophobia, not that there was a before, but there was a relative before and then an after. And what has happened is their sense of alienation has gotten much more severe, but also, at least in the United States, their sense of solidarity and activism with other groups, with Black Lives Matter, with LGBTQ groups, with undocumented immigrant groups. Recently in North Carolina, a lesbian gay center was closed down, and the first campus group to show up was Muslim Students Association. And then the second was Black Lives Matter. And the third was immigrant justice. And right now, partly because of the administration we're living in, people understand their shared fates. All right, so it's just all far more complex and intersectional. So this was lesbian pride during Eid. These were all over the website. All right, I'm gonna take you inside one more project for maybe 10 minutes. Is that, am I all right on time, Ete? Whoever is the goddess of time, am I all right? Oh, that seems absurd that I should talk that long. but I wanna take you into this project. Let me just make sure I've said everything. I took notes when you were all talking about, I just love living libraries, love. All right, so in a few years, like a year and a half ago, this part sounds like a joke, but it's not. All right, so three lesbian philanthropists called us and said, will you do a project on LGBTQIA young people? Do you have all those initials here? Yeah? Okay, cool. Is someone calling me? Are we all right? Let's hear it for her. She's amazing. Thank you. So, you know, we, Maria, who runs the institute, and I said, you know, we don't study groups like that, because groups, like construct validity, they crumble. They're only groups because of some power, like because heterosexuals think we're in charge of the world. But they wouldn't be a group. It's like the kids with disabilities. Like, that's not really a group. Being deaf and having one leg and having a learning disability, like, that's not really a coherent group. So we don't do groups. And they said three things, and they offered us a lot of money. But that wasn't the big one. It's like, you're not doing this work just because you were unemployed. They said three things. They said, number one, have you noticed that most of the youth activist movements in the United States are run by, this is language young people use, queer youth of color? And it is true. LGBTQ kids are like in the forefront. I don't know if it's true in your countries. In our country, education, prison, environment, Black Lives Matter. It's so much for Irving Goffman and shame and stigma, because these are multiply marginalized kids who say, we are demanding a place at the table, and not the table that you have set. We're setting our own table, thank you. So we use Sarah Ahmed's work to talk about willful subjects, that no matter how marginalized, this is a group of young people who stand up for justice. Not to say that some aren't totally alienated and outside and depression and suicide, and I will get to that. But among those who are activists, there is just a disproportionality around LGBTQ and young people of color. They also said there's a lot of money being spent on LGBTQ young people, a lot. And it focuses on three or four outcomes. I wonder if they're the same in your countries. What do we study on LGBTQ young people in your countries? Or do we not study, do we not say the words out loud? Depression is a big one. We have tons of studies on depression. Suicide, homelessness, and AIDS. So if a Martian came down and said, what's it like to be LGBTQ? You would know they're depressed, they kill themselves, they don't have a house, and they have HIV. So they said, you know, it's a real damage-focused literature. Do you think you could do the kind of work you do, like a PAR thing? So we did. And it has been the coolest, craziest project. So these are some of our co-researchers. I'm going to try to do this quickly. We put together an advisory board of adults and youth. Everybody, probably except for me, was LGBTQ and or of color and or an activist in that movement or in the arts. And then we identified like 50 organizations around the country that work with LGBTQ youth. But they weren't just LGBTQ organizations. They were spoken word and marching band and gay fraternities at universities and people who were running trans internet online communities. And we contacted all of them and basically said, can you have a survey making party? That is, we want to create a survey that's going to go out to the whole country. We eventually got 6,000 respondents. But we want questions from like rural Jackson, Mississippi, and Seattle, and Texas, and Puerto Rico, and New York City. We don't want it dominated by New York City language, issues, etc. So there were like 40 survey-making parties around the country. We just sent them like credit cards for pizza and whatever, and kids scenting questions. Got it? Then they had survey-taking parties, but it also went alive online, and we just kept getting. And then we had survey analysis party at the Graduate Center with our youth researchers. All right? So the respondents, then our youth co-researchers were 40 young people from 10 communities around the country. Each place sent 4 young people. We brought them in. They were 17 to 21. And they would do the critical statistics on the spot. I'll give you an example of that. They would do analysis with us, open-ended and closed-ended items, and they are now working on products including a card game of some of the qualitative data. The card game is called Radical Wit, because they're very funny. All right. So this is the philanthropic pickup line. Have you ever noticed that leaders of major groups are queer? All right. This is us just showing off about our fancy sample. So once we had what we call the bad draft of the survey, which is what we always intentionally call it, it was an amalgam of standardized questions and homegrown items from around the country around education, policing, housing, health, desire, activism, community, humor, what do you do in your spare time? If you were going to make a banner, what would it say? All right, so we had all those questions. So we had a gathering where we invited young people in to take the survey and critique it. Make sense? We thought we would have 40, and we pay everybody for everything. So we paid young people $15 an hour for 4 hours. So they were, of course, texting each other. It was a deli on 45th and Lexington. We expected 40, 250 young people came. Maria and I are running up and down the steps with rye bread and orange juice, and the Korean deli owners are like, who's here, what? One of the young people said, I've never been with this many young people who are like me without going through metal detectors. Somebody brought their mother. It was just a gorgeous range of young people. It started with everybody got paper and pens and just we made movies of what do you need the world to know about LGBTQIA young people, and they just did posters. I want to go back to this though. This session your conversations this morning reminded me. This was a very hard session because we were treating the group like it was homogeneous when they were really diverse. We had an item, some of the young people wanted us to ask, what was your sex at birth and what is your self-identified sex now? So the trans kids really wanted that question. The gender fluid kids hated it. And they're not all in love with each other. Like, so much for, they're young people, they've had very different experiences. I was working with a group of young people in a quiet room about hard questions. So there were 250, they were all over the place. We were working on, it was a group of deaf lesbians from Delaware in one room, a group of formerly incarcerated kids, group of private school, a real range. So I was working on difficult questions. And I said, we don't need to ask about depression and suicide, right? There's just a ton of data on that. And they were like, are you kidding, lady? Like, we need to ask, do you think about it every day, every week, every month, every year? Have you tried it? Have you been hospitalized? Have you stopped a friend? Have you lost a friend? And suddenly, I realized this isn't just epidemiological surveillance. This is existentially meaningful. If you've worked with heroin users, you know these dynamics where, oh, this is really important. This is really important. I said, I actually like the neuropsych work that shows that structural oppression moves under the skin. There are some very good, maybe none of your best friends are neuropsychologists. There's some very good neuro work about how it's called allostatic load, stressors in the world move under the skin and get us sick, right? All of your friends who now have autoimmune disease, a lot of that's related to early stress when the myelin sheath is developing. A lot of your friends have high blood pressure and by race, by category, by neighborhood. So I said, what stressors should we include if we asked about stressors in your life? And one kid said, I don't know how to put this on a survey, but This was a gender ambiguous African American young person with the baseball cap who said, every time the police stop me and frisk me, they think I'm a girl. And then when they realize I have testicles, they beat me up. Right? So there are moments like that where you realize, why are we serving 6,000 people? Why don't, right? But there were two, another lesbian woman who's young, 17, who said, you know, when I walk down the street, the police say sexist things to me. But when I'm walking with my girlfriend, the police say, I want to F both of you. Right? And all the other kids are doing this. Like, oh yeah, they do that to me too. Right? So, you know, that's nowhere in our data, except it's everywhere in our data. So figuring out what are we studying? Like, not only do they know what life is like at the rim, but they know things about police that I don't know. Right? They know things about the sexual violence enacted by police that I don't know. So we ended up with, I'll teach you Yiddish, a Meshuggah survey, like nuts, fabulous, gorgeous, and an amazing sample. So creating these categories, huge fights, just I'll leave it there. The kids were led, the youth researchers, the co-researchers, when we finally got all the data, two things happened. One is we do what's called critical statistics. In the moment, we will analyze the data. So there were four trans women from New Orleans. There were like 17, dressed to the nines. I'm dressed like I usually dress. They are dolled up to come to research camp. And if they passed eighth grade, I'd be shocked. But they could do critical statistics. So can you see if your parents threw you out of the house between 14 and 17, are you more likely to be picked up by the police by the time you're 17? Okay, so if you're picked up police when you're 17, are you more likely to be homeless when you're 18? And then are you more likely to be unemployed? And then by the time you're 21, are you more likely to be selling your body for money? And like they were doing log linear regression models. When we looked at the data by suicide, very high rates of attempted suicide. Even you could feel it right now, but in that room you could feel it, right? And just as a footnote, if you're going to do difficult work with communities that are impacted, make sure you are paying attention to affect. Make sure you have a way for healing, for dealing with tears. That I forget who said it this morning, but that is knowledge. I don't know how we've divided knowledge and emotions. Who cried? Was that you, Maria? And yeah, that's knowledge. That's embodied knowledge. And if you're doing research with a community, you could just feel. We just looked at the suicide stats, and we needed to do a whole set of healing practices. And we create graffiti walls in the room where you write the most distressing thing you read in a survey, the most hopeful, and where you think we need to engage in action. And we just cover the walls. It's like, you're all too young, but there used to be women's bathrooms would have really good stuff written on the walls inside the bathroom. It's like that, so there's an ongoing conversation. But each of these categories, the young people were really upset that after we opened up to their complexity, we were smushing them back in a box to do the survey. They want us to tell 6,000 separate stories. You think 120 is bad? But even stuff like 39% reported disability, we don't even know what that is. Is that a little boy is a little effeminate and a mother takes him to a therapist and then he gets bipolar and then identity, and is the identity on your data, is that a way to get resources or a way to get stigma or both? Some of them wear the disability as a badge, others are ashamed by it. So all of these categories are tricky. What's a youth of color? The dark-skinned kids were really pissed off that light-skinned kids were included in youth of color. They wanted them in some, we didn't know their skin color. They included the question about religion. I never would have. But they wanted you all to know that a quarter of themselves consider themselves religious, but 80% of them feel like their priest, their imam, and their rabbi don't respect them at all. So we opened with, and I recommend you always do this, we just open with, give us 5 words to describe you, right? We were getting out of the frame of, are you queer? Are you killing yourself? So, you know, we have many of these. And they're beautiful, and we send them out to therapists because people keep saying to me, you know, young people in rural Michigan come to me and they don't even have words, so I'm trying to give them words like lesbian, bisexual, but maybe the words are wrong. Maybe. So we say, you know, here's what 6,000 young people said about themselves. So I don't know if you can see any, but they're adorable, they're funny, they're sad, they're great, they're human. Then we, for every demographic category, we open, we start with an open-ended. So I think we've ended up with like 50 genders, 150 sexualities, and it doesn't matter. The point is to ask for the complexity. When we now work with social workers and lawyers, they say, I don't know what demisexual is. If they write gray asexual, that's not the point. The point is let people describe themselves, and then they're willing to put themselves in boxes because they know the world's a little narrow. But big fights, if I'm a trans man, am I a man? What do I know? They were really committed to creating more than evidence of their struggles. And so, in the middle of this survey that's asking very personal, very activist, very, where do you find community? Tell us your proudest moment. And again, we have 6,000 of them. And we're now meeting with subgroups for them to analyze. So we met with Muslim LGBTQ folks in New York City, and we took the 80 Muslim respondents. We met with Mormon. You don't get how funny it is that these categories are intersecting, but they are, and it's fabulous because it counters every stereotype. Then we met with a group of intersex folks. Do you know what that is? Where you're born with both male and female, either genitalia or chromosomes, or right? So we didn't even ask about it. The intersex community was furious that we didn't, but some self-identified. So we met with a group of intersex folks who have both male and female. The 5 we met with all looked like just very beautiful, traditional-looking women who were all wearing T-shirts that said, ask me about my balls. Right, so we're doing like evidence-driven focus groups with groups to add to the complexity. I'm gonna end with the banners. So in the middle of this survey, we just said, if you were gonna create a banner, what would it say? So I'm gonna add, this is the participatory part. Sorry, web land people, but those of you in the room, I want you to find your favorite banner and read it out loud. And then in the parentheses is how they self-described their gender, their sexuality, and their race ethnicity. I have 6,000 of these, but I won't show them all. Anybody got one you like? Look at their ethnic self-description, whiter than a Republican debate in the Alaska panhandle. Anybody else? This is before Trump. Woman, queer, immigrant, Mexican. How much more powerful could I get in this country? Dykeness, cisgender, Mexican to the core, Maya asked. Yeah. Amazing, right? Just like, wait in the middle. There was one, there were a lot about disability. One was, I'm a lesbian, I'm autistic, and I go to Harvard. Can I go back to bed now? I love the first one. We're all born naked and the rest is drag. And then the self-description is gold star, platinum, double mile, gay, who knows what that is, male with some drag queer influences, sombrero, AF. Do you know what AF is? Thank you, sir. I thought it was Afro-French. So the young people, so it's sombrero as fuck, Latino and Native. A lot of very political ones. The hashtags are all black people who have been killed by police. Tamir Rice. A lot about disability, flexing my complexion over whites. Hug a gay Mormon, we exist. And then there are some just nerdy science ones, like lesbians just have more orgasms than straight women. And then there are ones that sound like they'd be very sad until you look at their self-definitions, like how am I still here? Blackity black, I'm black, y'all, and Afro-Latinx. So we're still working through these. We are creating amicus briefs in lawsuits for trans bathrooms. We are publishing scholarly articles just on adolescence, just trying to invade worlds that have segregated or pathologized this community. As I said, we're creating a card game of these called Radical Wit. I will send it to you. It'll be online and free. And we've got some really beautiful quantitative data, and I will just give you a taste of it. Of course, being discrimination and oppression have bad consequences for mental health and suicidality. But having a relationship with one teacher so diminishes the relationship between external stressors and bad health outcomes. And I know you're all like so aware of the ones that got away, but I want to remind you of the ones that you've touched that you don't even know you've touched. And I know you're all aware that you can't stop the acid rain from coming down, but you hold umbrellas every day, and it matters so much. Just to be recognized for who they are. You know, we ended up writing about a justice of redistribution in our country. The inequalities are enormous. But a justice of recognition and participation are almost as important. Right? I don't want to compare them. Having a good shot at education really matters. But if you walk in and you're only invited to be what the dominant group is, it just feels wretched and people leave. The last thing we're doing is we developed a dignity school scale. Of the 6,000, we asked how many of you go to a school where there are out teachers who are gay, lesbian, bi, or trans. How many of you go to a school with the Gay Straight Alliance? Is that language you know? Like a allies group, whatever. How many of you go to a school where history, English, and sex ed include LGBTQ material? All of these are free, my friends. These are not expensive interventions to allow teachers to be out, to have a club, and to make sure your curriculum is accurate. Do you have an anti-discrimination policy? Are there counselors who are gay affirming? Kids who said yes to, we had 7 indicators, but they were all like nothing and everything. It's like relationship. Kids who said yes to 5 of those 7 had much lower bullying, school pushout, mental health problems, and suicidality. That's amazing. You know, I'm so glad we have 6,000 to be able to say empirically, we now know if you go to a place that welcomes you, and allows your teachers to be their full selves, and teaches in a way that includes everybody's history and language, it's just good for everybody. It's good for the kid with Down syndrome who's getting beat up in the school. I swear to you, when teachers are allowed to be out, that kid's less likely to be, that the school isn't held together by lies and gotcha and hiding. A school is held together by vulnerabilities and openness and relationships. So we're now doing a project with out teachers in New York City. New York City is probably, you know, on this score, one of the coolest cities in the world. Teachers are protected to be lesbian, gay, bi, trans, but they're not protected to be out. So if a teacher is out and somebody calls anonymously and says there's a teacher speaking inappropriately to children about sex, an investigation is launched. So there's a very gorgeous, very diverse group of educators who asked us to do a PAR project with them. So 2 weekends ago, we had 5 rooms. One room where some of them were making videos. And they were just beautiful about why it's good for everybody. And it's like, I'm Black, Haitian, gay, third grade teaching man, and my kids met my fiance and just fell in love. And after that, everybody's gay mother and trans sister and blind brother, and everybody started coming to my room to open up the... But that was only one group. Another group told their stories just as you were doing, and we're creating like an online, like an archive of the gifts you bring. We're calling a lot of things the gifts you bring. Another group just did freedom dreams, what these teachers wish for their schools and their students. Another group just did stand-up stories. They didn't want anything documented. But it felt like this revolutionary moment in 2019 in New York City. Shocking to me, really. But it's not just good for the kids, it's just good for all of us. So thank you for stories, thank you for the work you all do. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. That's really inspiring, and we got a lot of work to do. So to round up this whole event, we got our, I need to have a look on all the English words, our vice leader of Department of Educational Science, Meril Sandebililnes, and you would like to say a few final words?
Yes.
Super.
Do you hear me with this one? Nei, jeg trenger ikke. Hva tenker du skifter over? Oh yeah, no, I don't have anything to show for. Not presenting a PowerPoint today. But I need my notes. Well, first I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the privilege of concluding this nice conference. Presenting valuable perspectives. However, thinking of who am I responsible to, I feel it necessary to warn you that this perspective comes from a neuroscientist. So please bear over with me in regards to the subjects and stuff. So nonetheless, I would also thank the wonderful speakers who made this day very interesting and also valuable and gave me knowledge, and probably to the rest of you here as well, and good examples on, for instance, the importance of understanding the complexity we're in as individuals, as teachers, as scientists, and more. How co-researching can enable students in new ways. How the indirect approach can affect the power balance. However, also imposing ethical dilemmas on such as how to allow them to tell their story and not forcing them, as well as indirect enigmas on how to provide opportunity when they cannot use words. But then Ms. Fine here also showed that you can visualize it, so there are different ways, obviously. However, by generating a language to discuss these things, it enables you then to make teaching and research sustainable, also making the environment student-centered, where you do co-create findings and also implications generating co-knowledge. These are new terms for me, and I really like them. Also, this further sort of empowers you also to influence parents, school teachers, head of schools, local politicians, community leaders, and thus influence the sector as well as both on national, maybe also international level. So this is big stuff. And it will be interesting to see if any of you in the future will become politicians. I hope so. but most importantly, you are giving the young people a voice. And as you say, when they share their secret story, it comes with great responsibilities. And these and many more aspects were presented here today, very nicely enlightening the important work that you're doing here. And obviously makes it different for the students, marginalized or not, presented or proved by the May students presenting here today. That was really nice listening to you. In the Norwegian perspective, all of these things are also highly relevant for what we call fagfornyelsen. I didn't find a very good English translation for that. Google suggested, I think, it was subject renewal. But I think a curriculum renewal is more appropriate. And making it short, fagfornyelsen involves renewing all school curriculums to make them more relevant for the future. And the overall part of the fagfornyelsen has three main interdisciplinary themes, which is democracy and citizenship, sustainable development, as well as public health and livsmestring, clumsily translated to by myself, coping with life. If any of you have a better suggestion, I would like to take that, because that is a term I'm very fond of in Norwegian, and it's very important in everything we do, I think. And your approach is relevant for most of these things, or maybe all of them, in one way or the other, connecting, interacting in an interdisciplinary manner, bringing the professions out of the classroom and into action. That is my words. And personally, I find your methodology and strategy also highly relevant for other professions and also other educations, especially now that most educations are supposed to be research-based. Also when complicity should be promoted and using the students' lives experiences is an asset for research. At least that's my opinion as well. So. And further, I believe that you will not only facilitate research-based education in academia and improve higher education institutions' retention rates, speaking of English. but I think more, you also have a second larger impact. It's facilitating individual sense of achievements. I think building confident young people who will be making good decisions for the future. And preventing not only dropouts, but also generating highly warranted awareness on many different things. So I wish you all the best of luck in your research and in the co-generation of knowledge, influencing the students and everyone that is involved, who will pass it forward. And by that, contributing and taking this one step in the right direction towards equality for all, to be a bit bold, I think that's allowed. We have to have big thoughts in order to achieve great things. So, and when good things are done and shared, it will grow and make a difference. So, congratulations on this initiative making a difference. Thanks.
Thank you, Meryl. Encouraging, thank you. This is now the end of our conference.
And again, we'd just like to thank all of our guest speakers and to you, our delegates, both here in Norway, and hello to everybody on the webinar in Denmark and UK and hopefully across the world.
We would like to say thank you for everyone who's contributed and everyone who showed up. We are very grateful, and safe journey home.
Thank you.